I think we just we need to make a wee start. I think. Good morning, and welcome to the first meeting in 2016 of the Health and Sport Committee. I would ask everyone in the room at this point, as I normally do, to switch off mobile phones, as they can interfere with the sound system. But you will also notice that there are some of us using tablet devices instead of our hard copies of our papers. We have received apologies this morning from Rhoda Grant, who is unable to attend. Our first item on the agenda today, of course, is our first evidence session on the Burial and Cremation Scotland Bill. Bills, I should point out at this time, by their nature, have to be very precise in their meaning and their language that they use. And as such, there may be some language and terminology used this morning, which some people might find upsetting. So I wish to apologise in advance of that, if that does occur. It's not our intention to cause any offence, but the language and terminology of the bill that we're working with. And I would like to welcome this morning to the committee Willie Reid. We're expecting Cheryl Buchanan, and we'll welcome Cheryl when she comes. And McMurray, Stillbirth and Neonatal Death Charity Scotland SANS. Willie, you're prepared to make an opening statement to get us underway here this morning, I understand.
Yeah.
Please do that then, okay. And then we'll take some questions.
Thank you very much for having me along here today. Just to give you a kind of brief history and where I stand on that, I'm an affected parent. My daughter died sadly in 1988. And was cremated at Morton Hall. I'm not going to go into the full details of the surroundings to that, but more to what's happened since the story broke about the baby ashes scandal. And the big thing that I found was the political side from it. Right at the start, I personally wrote to Mr. McCaskill, the then Justice Secretary, got no reply from him, wrote to the First Minister, Mr. Salmond, and it took 7 months for us to get a voice here in the Parliament from the government level. And at that point, Mr. Salmond, I was calling for a public inquiry. Mr. Salmond, although Dame Angelini was doing the Morton Hall report on behalf of Edinburgh Council, Mr. Salmond commissioned Lord Bonamy to carry out an infant cremations commission. The downside to that was there was a political fight between the government and Lord Bonamy about having parents on that committee, and none were. And I find I thought at that point we were kind of sidelined. Lord Bonamy suggested that the emotion of it would be too great, and I just found that to be of the kind of thoughts of how things were in years gone by, as opposed to what happens in modern day. So the next thing that was after Lord Bonamy reported with these 64 recommendations was the bill was announced, and the HMI cremations was announced as well. Now, that was an appointment that was announced in shining light, shall we say. Then when the post was actually advertised, it came out like a two-watt bulb. It was only a part-time post for 90 days, and there's 27 crematoria in Scotland. How can they be snap-inspected and inspected with such a kind of low or, part-time role? However, Mr. Swanson has been appointed to that and appears to be doing a fantastic job. The bill has then been sent out in draft, and my big concern from it is that I worked within the cremation procedures subcommittee on that in the Scottish Government National Committee. However, the death of a baby or the loss of a baby starts right at the beginning, normally within a hospital, then goes on to undertakers and then on to the cremation authorities. Now, my personal experience was I never spoke to anyone at a crematorium. Everything was done through undertakers. So they were the ones who gave me a forum. And I was a 22-year-old young lad who 2 days before had lost my baby and was asked to sign this forum. Now, at that point, I was told you didn't get ashes from babies. But 25 years later, on site of the forum, there's a tick in the back saying disperse the remains. Why would I have wanted the remains to be dispersed if they were never there? So my big point about this is the funeral directors, they have a big part to play in this, and they don't appear within the legislation. And I think they're the ones who are the first contact, need to be licensed and regulated as part of this bill. How do we do that? I don't know the right way. However, an extension to the Her Majesty Inspectorate of Cremation's role could incorporate that. Again, it would be easy to say license them at local authority, but I think given the nature of what this is, they'd have to be licensed and regulated nationally so that every undertaker in the land carries out the same procedures, whether it's an adult cremation, baby cremation or whatever. That would be a hard job for an inspector to go around and inspect on his own, and obviously understand the austerity measures that were in it at the present. So one suggestion that I would like to put forward was bringing in something akin to custody visitors that they have in police custody centres and prison visitors. And these people who would, in the large, be voluntary, could go around and inspect and look at what undertakers are up to and then report to the HMI. The big thing about this bill is it has to go forward so it's not, it just won't allow the procedures of the past to continue, but it has to ensure they can't continue. There has to be some sort of censure to those who contravene it. For example, if I get caught speeding, I know I'm going to get a £60 fine and 3 penalty points. If I carry a knife in public, I'm liable to an imprisonment of 5 years. If I commit murder, then life. There's nothing in the bill suggests that if anyone contravenes any of the procedures within there, what the censures are. The other big thing that I think that we have to ensure is, as the bill is worded and written out, is when there are contraventions, then the investigation and subsequent censures have to be robust. They have to be swift, and they have to be fair, more especially to the parents. We're now going into the fourth year of the scandal since it broke at Morton Hall. And personally, I'm still being played as a kind of legal football between the lawyers of Edinburgh Council and the lawyers representing parents. Should this happen, and hopefully it won't, but should this happen to any affected parent in the future, then I don't think it's right that the length of time that we've been involved in this should be the time that they are expected to in the future. The effect of losing or someone dying, we all are going to die at some stage. However, a baby's death is slightly different because the mother and the father, you are looking forward throughout a pregnancy for the arrival of that child. Now, it doesn't matter at what time or of gestation that the baby's born or lost. Joy turns to instant pain. That in itself takes a long time to get over. To revisit this 25 years later has been the most horrendous thing I've had to deal with in my life, and I'm sure I speak on behalf of other parents who feel the same. So ultimately, this bill has to ensure that this can't and won't ever happen again.
Thanks, Willie. And do you wish to add anything to that?
I think I would just agree with Willie in the sense that for parents who were affected, I am a bereaved parent, but I wasn't affected by the Ashes scandal, thankfully, that for this whole process, it's given them renewed grief, so they're right back to the very day that this happened to them. And for me, I just wonder what concerns the committee would have for those parents and what support and mechanisms can we put in place to ensure that they do get the right support to get through this renewed grief and trauma that this has caused.
Thanks, Anne. We're going to move to some questions now in and around the bill, and I'm sure maybe picking up some of the points that have been made already. Bob Doris for our first question.
Thanks, Convener, and can I thank Willie Reid and Anne McMurray for not just your opening statement, Willie, but for being prepared to give evidence here today. Just wanted to mirror back a couple of things that you said, Mr. Reid, just so that you know we are listening, okay? So you're very keen to say to see when there is a breach of what should happen, that there's effective enforcement, and that there's sanctions in place, and there are consequences, and people are held to account. Now, how that happens is another thing altogether, but I was listening carefully to that, and I was listening very carefully to the idea of consistency to make sure that we know it doesn't matter which local authority in or what crematory is involved, that we have that consistency. Now, I am initially going to just restrict myself to some of the provisions within the bill, because part of this process is we will help shape this bill as it goes through Parliament, but we have to also be sure the parts of the bill that you are supportive of, as well as other things that you would like to see improved, and that's part of the process. I'm going to pick a couple of bits of the bill that I would like to find out if you are supportive of that, and that's the reason for asking that question, because we have to prepare a Stage 1 report to order us to make recommendations to the Scottish Government. So I'm looking deliberately at my briefing for today's session. So one of the things that is contained within the bill at Section 38 is that it's now expected that ashes will normally be recovered in the vast majority of cases, but where this does not occur, the Inspector of Crematoriums will investigate. Now, understand there may be concerns about what does that mean in practice, but is that in itself, is that a positive step forward? I'm going to roll that together just with a second thing, okay? So there's that, the fact that it is expected if there are not ashes as a result of a cremation, there will be an investigation of some description. And also at Section 55, and apologies for, I want to be very specific about the different parts of the bill, hope that's okay with you. There will also be a register of disposal of remains, which is a duty on each health authority to maintain a register recording the disposal of remains when pregnancy loss occurs. And we're talking about normally before 24 weeks. And obviously the healthcare system's maybe not as good as it could be in relation to how they deal with the pregnancy loss before 24 weeks. So there has to be a register for that. And there also has to be an investigation in each instance when there is a cremation that no remains are found. So as we go through this bill, we have to assure ourselves the bits of the bill that are fit for purpose and the bits that need improvement. So I've deliberately picked two very specific bits, and I hope that's helpful for you. So some comments on either of those two things would be very welcome by the committee.
Certainly, for the investigation, it's very much welcomed that the cremation authority have to inform the HMI cremations of any failure to recover ashes. I think Dame Angelini's Morton Hall report, with the technical support that was given to there, it states that ashes could normally be recovered after 16 weeks. The definition of ashes has been changed, and that's highlighted in the bill. So I would like to think that should the procedures that are adopted from the National Committee, if every local authority, every cremation authority abides by that, then there should be ashes at every stage. As for the registration of the remains, I'd maybe ask Anne to comment on that, because that's maybe something that I'm not overly familiar with and didn't really look into prior to coming here today.
I'm going to come in and maybe make a comment on that, but there'll be parts of the bill where you will feel the need to make a comment, and other parts where maybe you haven't looked at it because it wasn't at the front of your mind, and that's fine as well, you know, to say that. So thanks, Mr. Reid. I don't know, Anne, if you want to add anything.
No, I think we welcome the registration of pre-24-week babies. I would also just like to add that in the majority of cases, those babies would still, if they were cremated, they would still be able to obtain ashes. It would only be in the very early losses from 12 weeks below that they would normally not have an individual cremation. So therefore, although there would be ashes from a communal cremation, parents wouldn't be able to get individual ashes because they wouldn't be able to identify those. But there would still be ashes which would then be scattered in a sacred place in the crematorium.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you, Convener.
Okay. Now move to Richard Lyle.
Thank you, Convener. Wally, can I say your opening statement was very powerful, and I'm sure many of the committee take on board what you've already said. But if I can turn to, you know, I'll bring Anne in if possible. One of the submissions we got, a parent stated that their daughter died at 23 weeks of gestation. The cremation was organised by a local maternity hospital. At the time, she was not given the option of burial via the hospital or privately. Minutes after her death, she was handed a cremation form to sign. She had been sedated shortly beforehand. The procedure was not shown the forms, and they were not explained to her. At no point were the forms ever explained, as I say. In your submission and on behalf of SANS, you basically, whilst you welcome many parts of the bill, you disagree with the proposal of the bill to create a single application form to cover all cremations, both for adults, children, babies who die, and you're basically suggesting it should be separate forms. And Wally covered it in regard to the point of who should be involved, who should be explaining what's happening. Should it be the undertaker? Should it be the hospital? You know. So basically, if I could ask both of you, and as I said, sorry if I'm maybe touching on points that are very sore. Basically, who do you think should have should the form be multi-purpose, or it should be separate forms for each issue, each case, type of case? If you could maybe explain what you mean, Anne, by your submission, and maybe Wally could maybe tell us where you think the forms should be with, either the hospital, undertaker, or who else?
I think in the most part it would probably be more than likely be the hospital, because that's where the parent is more likely to be when that event occurs. With regard to being separate forms, it really pertains to the very early losses, because for some parents who have had a termination for fetal abnormality, for those who choose to have a termination for whatever other reason, they might not want to have a form that says baby on it, and it might be more distressing for them. So that was really the main reason for the separate forms. It's unlikely that parents would go directly to a funeral director, because, as I say, the event is normally happens within the hospital. And so, therefore, it would be the hospital that would deal with the parents initially. But I think it's important that parents are given the choice to speak to a funeral director, that the hospital shouldn't always take ownership of that process, and that's what sometimes happens as well. So parents are then not given the choices. I think with the set-up of the subcommittees, and we're looking at training and procedures, within that committee we're looking at making sure that the staff that deal with parents have as much information as they can that they can pass on to parents, so that they can make an informed choice about what will happen to their baby.
Boy, the point that Anne was making about, undertakers.
Yeah, I mean, things may have changed. I mean, we're now almost 28 years since the loss of my daughter. However, it was the hospital who guided me to the undertaker. And basically, I gave all the details of what happened, and undertaker filled out this form and then said, here, sign that. Now, my mother passed away just 8 months ago, and I went and seen an undertaker about her cremation, and right again, there was the undertaker quite happily filling away the form. Now, I'm a wee bit more experienced this time, and I checked over everything before I signed it, but when you've just lost a baby, as I explained to you, the joyous occasion that's approaching, and then that's taken away from you, for forums then to be put under. I think there's maybe an onus on the hospital, maybe the hospital chaplaincy, and then on to the undertakers. But I don't think this forum should rest with just undertakers and the bereaved, or if there is, then there maybe has to be a 48-hour, 72-hour cooling period to then go back and say, here are your options, whether it's cremation, whether it's burial, or whatever else. 72 hours later, this is what we're going to go ahead with. Are you content with that? And then a counter-signature on the forum would probably be better than what was there before.
Can I just interrupt? There is the option that the parents have a timescale to be able to change their mind about what the decision that they've actually made. And I think it is about 3 days or 4 days.
I think that's something that would well be incorporated into the bill. And then every undertaker, every hospital unit have to then abide by that, because at the moment I would say it was just a guideline and a guidance as opposed to a part of the Act.
Is it more about the communication here?
It may well
because be. Because we're dealing with a traumatic situation.
But
some people will be able to cope with that. And in reflection, you know, asking the right questions, the communication better, then you would have been able to do that. But was it willful, this, you know, this neglect in a forum? When you reduce it to a forum, there's a paternalistic approach from whoever's in there to try and alleviate some of that sort of bureaucracy from the person who's dealing with a traumatic event. Is it more about the communication and helping people through that process? Or, you know, every question on a forum or you know, the language, you know, whether it's considered a baby, fetus, you know, can there be a standard, I'm suppose I'm asking, about how we should be dealing with it? Because everybody will be very, very different in terms of their coping. And
what you're saying there, but in years gone by, certainly my experience, it was a case of, oh, that's not so good, you've lost a baby, off you go, have another one and crack on your life. And that was society's view of it back then. Society has changed now, and if I'm going to be reflective in my life, I was the man. I had to organise a funeral and I had to do this and do the next thing. It took about 20 years for me to realise, you know what, I didn't do the right thing. And it came back to bite me, but that's another matter. But at the time, the forms have to be correct. They have to be, because, as I say, there was a tick in the box of my daughter's Form A that said, you know, dispose of the remains in the Garden of Remembrance. But the undertaker told me there wasn't any ashes. So, you know, was that willful? I would suggest it was.
I think communication does play a big part. So I think, again, there needs to be some sort of training programmes for everybody across the board, not just health professionals, but funeral directors and crematoria staff, to ensure that they give a consistent message to parents when they're arranging a funeral of their baby. I do believe that people don't set out to willfully mislead us. I think they think that they're doing the best for us. But hindsight's a wonderful thing, and honesty is much more acceptable than being led down a different route, because all of us would have made different decisions if we'd been given the correct information at the time, and also allowing parents to have that space to reflect on the decisions that they've made and the opportunity to change that decision.
Any other questions for committee members? Dennis Robertson.
Thank you, and good morning. With regard to the bill, the suggestions, say, within the hospital area, for instance, do you have a view as to who should actually provide the appropriate information in order that the parent and parents could make a decision with regard to the baby that's died, or indeed maybe a stillbirth prior to the baby being born? Do you have a particular view as to who should actually provide that information?
I think probably it would need to be an experienced staff member, and a lot of the hospitals now are using senior midwives who have a particular interest in bereavement, and therefore they would have most of the information that they need to have to pass on to the parents. But like Willie said as well, perhaps the hospital chaplains could be involved in that as well. And again, you know, there is only one paid bereavement midwife in the whole of Scotland. There are others who are doing the job but not recognised as that. And I think that's maybe, I know
so
it's another issue, but
could be,
it should be something that could be looked at.
Yeah. There's also part of the bill in terms of if there's a disagreement, say, within with the parents as to what should happen, it's suggesting that if you can't come to an agreement, then the courts should make that decision. Do you think that there's maybe another way forward, or do you agree with what's being proposed in the bill?
I think I agree with what's being proposed in the bill, but it would have to be something pretty traumatic for it to get to that stage.
Yeah.
But if there becomes then a legal battle or even a battle of wills between the cremation authority and the parents, I think a swift court judgment would be the best way forward.
You know, views on that, Anne? It's hard to imagine if we get to that stage,
yeah,
I suppose.
Yeah. I just,
but I've got to take that into account. Yeah, yeah. Malcolm?
Thanks very much for your statements at the beginning and the questions. It's very, very helpful for us. I mean, Willie, you said you wanted to see a bit more in relation to funeral directors, and you talked about inspections, so that would be one way of dealing with it. Do you think, well, I suppose two questions, what are the concerns you have about them? You've described some of them, but should there be anything in the bill specifically, apart from inspection, should there be any requirements of funeral directors that are not in the bill that could be put in the bill, if you see what I mean?
Yeah, I could go out and start an undertaker's business tomorrow with no training, no licence, no nothing. You know, get a couple of horses together and there I am. And I suppose like any business, you're always going to get your rogue traders. However, I think all undertakers should be licensed. They should be licensed nationally. They should be regulated so that they all carry out this, not just the service, but the procedures building up to whether it's a cremation or a burial, the same way nationally. And as I said earlier on, if they contravene that, then there has to be some sort of censure available when they do it. Because, as I said, they are the first point of contact for a funeral, but particularly with a baby. As I say, they were the ones that kind of fed me down this, there are no ashes. I never spoke to MD at a crematorium. I never spoke to, you know, to the hospital about it. It was undertakers that completely and utterly fed me that. My knowledge is that a lot of your small family undertakers are being taken over by the bigger businesses throughout the country. So I think the bigger these companies are, then the more profit they're going to be looking for. But I'm not particularly interested in what profits they make. What I'm interested in is the way that they treat families, the way that the forms are filled out, and the fact that there should be some sort of corroboration to what they're doing with these forums. And as I say, it's the kind of 72-hour... what's the word I'm looking for? Kind of lay-off period, or, you know, period to reflect on what we're doing. That should be there. And then, you know, a second signature by the parent who's organising the funeral, so it's not just one signature at that time, and off they go.
Do you want to comment on that, Tara?
I think a lot of us have concerns that there is no regulation for funeral directors or no regulatory body. Some of them are affiliated to their own bodies, but there are independent funeral directors out there as well. So I think for us, we would want to see a consistent approach, that they all have the same sort of training in their background, and the approach that they have when dealing especially with vulnerable parents, because you lose other family members, and yes, it's traumatic, but the loss of a baby is just, it's unthinkable for everyone. And it's something that you just learn to live with. It's not something you ever get over, but you learn to live with it. And I think, you know, any death is bad, but the death of a baby, people's instincts are completely awry, and they really need somebody to be very compassionate and caring when they're giving information to make sure that the wishes that they really do want are adhered to.
I mean, a lot of discussion obviously has been about the ashes, and there is, it's fairly very important in the bill what the bill says about ashes, but I wonder, are you, as I understand it, there'll still be some provision, well, ashes will be recovered whenever possible, or and, I mean, do you feel the provisions are strong enough, or do you still, could there still be worries that ashes could have been recovered but weren't, and is there anything more that could be done to ensure that they always are recovered, you know, whenever possible?
I think the bill does state that, you know, ashes is everything that remains after the last flame, excluding metals. And I think, as we've said already, I think they should be able to recover ashes from every cremation of a baby, no matter what gestation, apart from those very early losses where they are in a communal cremation. So, plus, it does say that if there are no ashes, then that will be investigated as to the reason why there were no ashes in that instance. So for me, I feel that it does cover that, and so parents can be reassured that in 99.9% of the time, there will be ashes from that cremation of their baby.
I think just to bring to the point, when I was sitting on the procedures committee for the National Committee, one of the phrases it was going about was to minimise the loss of ashes. And what I suggested, and I think was put into guidance, it was put out to all local authorities, it was to maximise the recovery of ashes. And I think it's all about putting the positive spin onto what's required, as opposed to the negative of what we don't want. So in the guidance that I certainly know has been issued to all crematorium authorities, it has been to maximise the recovery of ashes in every case.
Thanks.
Okay. Is there any other members? I've got members who wish to ask an additional question. Any members who have not asked a question wish to come in at this point? No. Bob Doris, followed by Richard Lyle.
Thanks, I hope there's not a bit of repetition here in saying this, but I just need to be clear in my head about a couple of things, if that's okay. Firstly, maybe just in terms of the idea of regulation of funeral directors, I have to get my head around how that would work, but I think you've made your point quite clearly in relation to that, but also in terms of where ashes are not recovered. So it's not just about identifying where that happens, but what are the processes that lead to the fact that ashes are not recovered, and if those aren't satisfactory, how do you make them satisfactory in the future? So it's about driving change in that process. So I get that, and I'm listening to that, and I think we have to go back and ask questions about that as well. But where I wanted to specifically come back in was the idea of the role of the funeral director, because let's work on the basis, I hope, that most funeral directors do have compassion, are sensitive. I recently, unfortunately, had to use a funeral director. My mother passed away in December. I suppose I would paraphrase that relationship with the funeral director saying to her family, what would you like to happen? And then they sought to make that happen. And yes, they went through a forum. But the importance of the forum for me wasn't what the forum looked like. It was that I understood what was happening, and I was very clear about what was happening. I can only imagine how much more difficult that is when it's a baby or an unborn child that you're having to go through that process with. which is why I'm coming back to that point again about the idea of a cool-off period or a single point of contact, whether it's at hospital or at a funeral director's, that takes you through that process. So a cool-off period where you have that initial conversation, maybe you look at a forum, maybe you don't, about what's happening. It's a cremation, whether there's likely to be ashes, what the process around that, as horrific as that's going to be when you've just lost a child. To have that conversation a second time could be doubly distressing, I suppose. So the point, the question I'm hoping to ask is it worth risking that additional distress at the very short term when you're in grief anyway, to make sure you've got absolute clarity and absolute certainty in the process, maybe at a time when a lot of grieving parents can't cope with it or don't think they can cope with it. So it's just, is there a tension there between putting something in place? Maybe there's not, maybe we should just do it, but is there a tension between putting something in place when you go back to a grieving family a few days later, when maybe they were struggling initially, and the funeral director or a single point of contact can help manage them through that process? But going back a second time may have unintended consequences. Is there a balance between that? Because if we were to recommend what you're suggesting, we would have to make sure there weren't unintended consequences. But I like the idea.
I think the best way to explain this to you is the current bills we have date back to 1905 and 1935 or 37. Yeah. So what we need to do with this bill is not just see what's right today, but see what's right in 50 years' time. Now, as I said in my opening statement, how the death of a baby was seen by society 30 years ago, 25 years ago, is completely different to the way things are today. And I think we've got to give humans a bit of credit that, yeah, where there is distress, that distress may be required to do the right thing. And what we've now, what's become apparent of this is because, I mean, in Edinburgh alone at Morton Hall, there was 153 cases, I believe. You know, so 153 times funeral directors and cremation authorities got it wrong. So in 50 years' time, we want that still to be none, because I believe in the last year there's been recovery of ashes every single baby cremation in Scotland. We don't have to go back through and over the whole form again, but I think it's just a check and balance. Can be a phone call, pop into the funeral director's office and say, this is what we're doing, are you content with that? Are there any changes you want to do or make? If there isn't, we count a signature to say everything's fine. I hear where you're coming from, but I'd rather that grief was, or that the potential grief that you're talking about was there and then at that time than in 25 years' time down the line.
Anne, I don't know if you want to add anything.
Yeah, it would be difficult, but again, I think if people have the right training, they'd be able to approach parents in a way that they would not be as upset as just a blank, right, we need to go over this form again. There are ways of speaking to the parents and asking them, we just want to make sure that you're wishes are what they are, that you haven't changed your mind, you were given. And they're told at the beginning that they have a cool-off period, that they have a period of time that they can reflect, and if they want to change their mind, they can do so. And at that point, they could say, we'll come back to you in a few days' time just to check that that's still your wishes. So there are ways that you can be gentle with parents without making them... They're not going to feel any worse than they do, actually.
I find the comments you've made very, very persuasive. I just wanted to be absolutely sure for clarity for the evidence that we are getting. So I found that helpful. Thank you.
Should the role of the funeral directors then be set out clearly in the bill?
I think, again, we don't need to look at... We're looking at today and what went wrong yesterday. But we really need to look at tomorrow. Because in 10, 15 years' time, this will have been a story that will be sent away into history, you know, and bad pennies can turn up more than once in a lifetime. And if they aren't, I just feel that the kind of at the moment the beam is on the funeral industry at the moment because of this scandal. Yeah. If we take that beam away and the beam is now that act, then, you know, your rogue trader could be back in 10 years' time, going back to the old practices and procedures. Just to kind of give to that, I mean, we're 4 years down the line from this ashy scandal coming out. And it's what I was saying to you about censure and punishment. There's been nobody put in a court of law of any sort in this country over what went on thus far. Now, I know Dame Angelini's still having their national investigation, but I'll go to my grave never knowing what happened to my daughter's ashes. The person who was responsible for doing that is walking about scot-free. And I'm not suggesting that we're looking for somebody to go to the jail right now for it, but, you know, if we don't make sure the act is watertight now, in 50 years' time, we could be back with a scandal all over again.
Richard Lyle.
Thank you, Convener. Can I say to Mr. Reid, when death comes to anyone's door and every family's door, it's a traumatic experience, and sadly, most of us have been through that with loved ones. And I don't take away the point that you've made about your daughter. And, I certainly agree with you. Can I turn to the point you made earlier? You welcomed the factor of the appointment of the inspectorate, but then went on and said it was only 90 days. And you then suggested that we should have local visitors who could possibly, appointed people who could visit undertakers or whatever. Would you like to expand on that? And also, prior to possibly another question I'd like to ask is, what is not in the bill? What do you think should be, is there anything else you think should be in the bill?
The HMI's one person, and he's got the task at the moment of inspecting 27 crematoria because the procedures have been changed and they have to be seen to be abiding by that. And obviously, if there's any investigations come about, he's then... So, you know, he's a one-man band, so to speak. If the undertakers were regulated and licensed, then, yeah, they would need to be inspected as well. And that would probably be too much of a job. I've no idea how many undertakers there are in Scotland, but I can guarantee it would be an awful lot more than 27 like we have in crematoria. And I think what I'm trying to get at is it's easy enough to, you know, to write to somebody and say, right, I'm coming to inspect your register, you know, because, if I can go back a wee bit, when the story broke, I went to the local undertaker who carried out my daughter's funeral, and they didn't have records. You know, so they should have records. That's probably the first thing. You know, even if it's just something, date and time of funeral, who organised the funeral, but they should be keeping a register as well as a crematorium. And it's just a case of, you know, ad hoc inspections by, as I say, these could be volunteers who are only getting expenses or, you know, given some sort of minimum remuneration countrywide that can just go into an undertaker and say, right, let me see what your last 10 funerals have been. And it's snap inspections. They're not given any warnings or whatever. And it's just so that someone is keeping them on their toes. And I think if they know that that's there, then the likelihood of them not doing the right thing would be very much minimised.
Would if you allow me, Convener, would these be appointed by the inspector? Many years ago, councils used to appoint prison... You were talking about prisons earlier, prison visitors, but that doesn't happen now. We've changed that system, to my knowledge. Would these people, you know, the sub-inspectors, let's say... would they be appointed by the inspector, or would they be appointed by the local council? What would your view be, if you could give me that?
I think they'd have to be independent of the council, because ultimately the council would be the cremation authority. So they'd have to be independent in some way. But I don't think I would have an issue of them being appointed and vetted for whatever with the HMI.
Yeah, that's the answer I was looking for. Thank you very much.
Dennis Robertson.
With regard to the records, do you think the bill should specify very clearly that all records for burials and cremations should be kept electronically and probably enable maybe a transition period for anything that's currently maybe recorded on paper to go electronically for ease of access and for obviously future records? I mean, we're in the 21st century. Do you believe that it should be an electronic register?
Yeah, I do. Because having now, 25 years later, seen the records that are held by Edinburgh Council and my daughter's cremation, you know, there's a register, and then all the forms are now into microfiche. They're actually quite difficult to read and whatever else. So I think that was one of the recommendations from Lord Bonamy, but there was a national computerised record. Yeah. That everyone.
And do you think the bill should specify that, actually?
Yeah, I would have no qualms with the bill specifying that, and, you know, basically putting onto these the cremation authorities, they must have it for them to run as an authority.
Yeah. And ease of access to the register should always be free of charge?
Very much so.
Okay. Thanks, Camilla.
I mean, you know, the bill said that the records must be kept of every burial and cremation, which wouldn't identify a woman who has experienced a praying of the loss or before 24 weeks, would be available also, not just to, but be available to the public. Do anyone, is there any concerns arise from you?
It's got to be available for the public, but like anything else, I think once it goes on to a computerised record, and I'm no lawyer, but the data protection would then come in to play on that, I would imagine. So maybe names and dates of birth be redacted, however the procedures of the cremation and what happened should be available. If it's an official body like a government body, then, yeah, obviously that redaction could be removed. But when it's open to the public, I don't think the public need to know the name and date of birth of, you know. With adults, I don't suppose it's a big problem, but I think with babies it's a little more sensitive.
I wouldn't have thought that it was a matter of public record, but it's available if you, as the parent, want to check those records. And also the fact that there is that anonymity for those parents whose baby is born before 24 weeks, as to how much information is given in that as well. But I do think it's important that these records are kept and that they are available for those parents that want to check.
But they would be available to the public, as far as the bill said that they would be available to the public, but the woman that wouldn't be identified, but
yeah.
Any other questions from the committee? Yes, of course.
Thanks, Convener. This is my last question, I promise. It's just, again, it all seems to come back to being sure what's happening within the process. Yes, having trust in the funeral directors and cremation authorities and crematoria, but having a check and balance in place to make sure they're doing what they say they'll do. And I think Mr. Reid gave the example about, you know, if someone was to go in and do a spot check, tell us about your last 10 cremations or burials or whatever that process would be. I suppose that would, and it's not your job to justify your alternative solution, but a general question I would like to ask on that about, I suppose a funeral director or a cremation authority could say there's the forms and the forms could be filled in perfectly, but forms could have been filled in perfectly 30 years ago, but it doesn't mean people knew what they were signing up to or they were complicit in how the forms were filled in. So I could imagine, again, the only real way of making sure that the process was dealt with sensitively is that vexed issue of going back to the parents and asking them how they felt the process was. And that brings me back to my last question, I suppose, about what parent really wants. How can I possibly know? I've not been in that situation. 3 months after they've buried or had their baby cremated, or 6 months or 9 months or whenever, I knock at the door, a telephone call or an email saying, can we just have a little chat with you about? And so I can see issues with that. That's not a reason not to do it. It's a reason to think carefully about how we make sure we're talking to parents. So maybe just some thoughts in after. So rather the detail of the suggestion that Mr. Reid made, because that would be unfair on you. It's not for us to interrogate that. It's to scrutinise the bill. But what's not in the bill, I suppose, is how we go back to parents after they've been through that horrible experience in the process of cremations and burials to see that they thought they were dealt with sensitively, appropriately, and had clarity and assurance in what was happening in the process. So I suspect that's not in the bill. How could we put it into the bill, and should we put it into the bill?
I don't know is the answer, but I mean, again, I think last year both you and I both lost our mothers, and after my mother died, I think it was maybe about a month to 6 weeks later, the crematorium wrote to me and said they want the name in their book of remembrance, and you know, how did things go? I think one way of adopting that would be, it would be part of the initial conversation right at the beginning, to say, you know, we've had your cooling off period, here you are, you've come back, this is what you want in your cremation and your cremation service. Would you object to us coming and speaking to you in 12 weeks' time, just to, you know, or the HMI coming and speaking to you in 12 weeks' time, just to ensure that everything went to your satisfaction? I would think you'll get some parents would say no, but I think the majority would be quite comfortable with that if they knew, you know, again, it's how that's, it's, you know, how that's given over. You know, it's not a, we're the Scottish Government and we're determined to come and see you in 12 weeks, you know. But, you know, in a more sensitive way, then I don't think that would be an issue.
I'm in two minds about that. I'm all for, looking out to see if things have been done. I think it would probably need to be longer than 12 weeks. But if it was part of the initial conversation, mm-hmm. and then it's, is it another tick box on the form to say, this parent would be comfortable with people. And they would have the option if somebody contacted them to say, well, actually, I've changed my mind. I don't want to, to make a comment. I don't know. But so I'm in two minds. I think it's another tick box and another exercise. That
those are the thoughts I had in my head as well, so thank you for putting that on the record. Thank you.
Okay. I think there was just a couple of wee things that we'd like to get for clarity. I'm looking for page 6 on the briefing in terms of the bill. We've looked at records as they apply to the funeral directors and notaries, and the bill explains that health authorities must keep records of what a woman decides to do when a pregnancy loss, and in many cases that's where the initial record would be, as well as what happens when the health authority is asked to bury or cremate those remains, and the information would be anonymous. You know, maybe a comment about that approach. I think it's been alluded to earlier. Should anyone check that the health authorities are keeping accurate records? I mean, who would do that? And how, I suppose the general question is, how would we be able to monitor that record keeping within the health service? And how?
I think in the majority of cases that parents are dealt with by the health professionals in the first instance. With regard to the keeping records, well, it will be on their health records, that information, so it's there already. So the onus is on the health professional to ensure that they update those records when they've spoken to parents. Because you have your...
So it shouldn't be separate, patient. It should just be part of somebody's medical record then?
Well, yeah, I think that information should be there. That obviously, it's there that you've had a stillbirth or a baby who's died before 24 weeks or whatever the situation is. Uh-huh. There should be some sort of information that they have spoken to them about funeral arrangements or passed them on to the funeral director, whatever the action was.
But that would prevent us having some overall check and monitoring of the system, because I'm looking around the year, but medical records are something that's not shared generally, it's private, so you wouldn't be able to ensure that there was a good that the public could be aware that the practice that the bill,
I mean, the only
hopes to achieve to establish would be could be monitored by the public like some of the other measures.
But if the hospital will have, I don't know what the word is, contracts with funeral directors if they're going to make the arrangements on behalf of the parents. So surely there must be a record trail of that.
I'm looking to you who have experience in these, you know, if you try to examine some of these records, would the records be there? The bill said that they should be in the future. So we presume that they're not regularly established now. But it's something we can explore.
I would think if the hospital have a contract with a funeral director to inter or cremate babies on behalf of the parents because that was the parents' wishes, they didn't want to be involved in that, then there should be some sort of mechanism in place where those records are there.
Okay. I would have thought it would be very strange for hospitals not to keep such records, but I've no experience in that. It's maybe worth something that you guys want to check out.
Yeah, if there was no right answers to these, but that was as good an answer we're going to get. Maybe we will ask those questions. I suppose the other one in terms of if the bill says that what should happen with record keeping and a woman loses her baby in the first 24 weeks of pregnancy, and this is the catch-all, that the bill says that a woman decides within a week of losing her baby that decision must be recorded and signed, but nothing will happen for a further 7 days. Suppose your earlier comments, is that sufficient? On the other side of that, we know from our caseloads, whether it's children or indeed adults, there are big cultural pressures in some of our communities, and we receive regular casework about the length it takes to get a funeral, etc., etc. Now, if this becomes standard, that's at least a fortnight before we're into another month. Now, I don't know whether you support this as a standard or whether it because if it becomes a requirement, it can cause some cultural problems, problems with certain defined communities who have a requirement to carry out the funeral service pretty quickly.
Sort of instinct with that is that if someone has a particular culture, that they wouldn't be adhering to that, they wouldn't be taking the choices of waiting a week or waiting another week to make that decision. The decision would be made that that's their culture and that's what they want to happen, that child would be buried or cremated within a certain period of time. I think that's whether it's right or wrong for that parent, but if that's their culture and that's what they believe, then they will just do that.
I think also in that sense that the option has to be there for that culture, or, you know, to say, yeah, your culture says you go ahead with that, however, here is what's in the Act gives you that option of waiting I don't know how that could be best written into the bill. I'm sure it would have to be accommodated, but I think doing the right thing, does that take precedence over a culture? I'm not. I don't know the answer to that.
No, it's not a question we can't answer because you know it maybe not apply to our given situation. But you know, if you have a bill that says that you know that even if the decision's recorded, and then it would be another waiting period of time, which I think Anne had mentioned was very, very important in terms of. That would be the rules, the law. So it's maybe something we can explore further.
I don't know. I think the question I'm going to ask is, because I don't know that, you know, the procedures, but surely the waiting time to get, you know, a cremation carried out, regardless of culture, isn't going to be instantaneous anyway. You may well, and I would imagine with the death of, especially with a neonatal death of a baby, there's going to be a post-mortem, you know, so any funeral isn't going to take place until after any post-mortem.
Mm-hmm. So maybe not matter, maybe not apply. Any other questions? Willie, Anne, thanks very much for your time here this morning. We're sorry that Cheryl hasn't been able to come, but obviously we've got Cheryl's written evidence, which we'll take into account when we complete our initial report. So as we come to the end of this session, thank you very much indeed. Anne, go on.
I didn't realise you were wrapping up there. I just wanted to say that as you started off this morning by apologising for some of the terminology that's used in the bill that we might be upset or offended by, I did ask that there should be something for any parent who wants to read that bill, that there should be something on it to, in a similar vein, that they may find some of the terminology, but it has to be there for legal reasons. So
you've just put it on the record, Matt, and that's a good final word. But Willie's determined that he's going to have a final word.
I know there are more parents coming to see committee members tomorrow in private,
yes.
But I think to finish off, I think the government need to get this right. Failure to get it right, and it isn't watertight, is just going to give a trauma that I never want any other person to go through. Babies are going to die, just like we are all going to die, but we definitely got to avoid this double grief that we've went through, and I just want to impress upon the committee to ensure that what we do is done right and for the best of intentions.
Thanks very much to you both for your contribution here this morning. Thank you very much indeed. We suspend at this point while we set up for our next session, don't we? We now move to agenda item number two, which is a decision on whether the committee will consider its future work programme in private at future meetings. Can I have the committee's agreement that we follow that custom and practice? Mm-hmm. Thank you. Agenda item number three, subordinate legislation. We have one negative instrument before us today. The instrument is Food Information Miscellaneous Amendments, Scotland Regulations 2015, SSI 2015-410. There's been no motion to annul, and the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee has not made any comments on the instrument. Do we have any comment from members? We haven't. Is the committee therefore agree to make no recommendation? Thank you. That is agreed. Agenda item number four, subordinate legislation. This time, one affirmative instrument. As usual with an affirmative instrument, we'll have an evidence-taking session with the Cabinet Secretary and their officials on the instrument. Once we have had all of those questions answered, we will then move to the formal debate on the motion. An instrument we're looking at today is a General Dental Council Fitness to Practise, etc. Order 2015 draft. And can I welcome, formally, the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Wellbeing and Sport, Shona Robison, and our officials, Ailsa Garland, Principal Legal Officer, Legal Director, and Jason Birch, Senior Policy Manager, Regulatory Unit, Health Directorate, all from the Scottish Government. Do the Cabinet Secretary wish to make some remarks?
If that's okay.
Yes, please. Thank you.
The Scottish Government and the health departments in the three other nations are committed to legislative change in healthcare regulation to enhance public protection, and that's why changes are being made to the General Dental Council's legislation through this order, which is made under the Health Act 1999. Within the last 3 years, the GDC has seen a 110% increase in its fitness to practice caseload, putting a significant strain on their resources. And in order to ensure public protection, the GDC needs to be able to expedite the fitness to practice complaints it receives. It's also clearly vital to prevent the GDC developing an unmanageable backlog of cases. Currently, the GDC's legislation can make it difficult to act swiftly when a complaint is received that a registrant's practice presents a risk to patient safety. To maintain patient safety, generate efficiencies and ensure confidence in dental regulation, changes are required in GDC fitness to practice processes at the investigation stage. Therefore, this order will make five key amendments to the GDC's legislation governing its processes. The first is to enable the GDC to make rules to allow for decision-making functions currently exercised by its investigating committee to instead be exercised by officers of the GDC known as case examiners. Currently, if a complaint is taken forward, the GDC must convene an investigating committee. But by using case examiners, a full investigating committee will not be needed for each case, leading to the swifter resolution of cases. As case examiners will deal with a higher volume of cases than the investigation committees, there's the potential for greater consistency in decision-making, further enhancing patient safety. Secondly, the proposals enable the investigating committee and case examiners to address concerns about a registrant's practice by agreeing appropriate undertakings with that registrant instead of immediately referring to a practice committee. For example, if a case involved an allegation that a registrant's health was affecting their fitness to practice, an undertaking could address any public safety risks, avoiding costs and saving time. However, the GDC's policy is that rules will ensure a registrant must not be invited to comply with undertakings if there is a realistic prospect of a registrant being erased from the register at a practice committee. Thirdly, the GDC will have the power to make rules so that the registrar can review a decision that an allegation should not be referred to the case examiners or to the investigating committee. This power also extends to review of a decision that an allegation should not be referred from the investigating committee or case examiners to a practice committee. The GDC's policy is that their rules will provide a review can only be undertaken by the registrar if the original decision was materially flawed or if new information has come to light, which may have altered that decision, and a review is in the public interest. Such a review can only occur within 2 years of the original decision to close the case. Fourthly, a power will be introduced to enable the investigating committee, which will be extended to case examiners through rules, to review their determination to issue a warning. At present, a registrant can only appeal the issue of a warning by judicial review, which, of course, is a lengthy and costly process. Finally, it's proposed that registrants will be able to be referred to an interim orders committee at any time during the fitness to practise process. This amendment removes ambiguity in the current legislation and ensures that those who are potentially unsafe to practise have their registration restricted while inquiries and investigations are made. These proposed changes are estimated to deliver approximately £2.5 million in annual savings for the GDC, which will no doubt help to reduce future pressure on registrant fees. It's also worth noting that the General Medical Council, the General Optical Council and the Nursing and Midwifery Council already use case examiners. All three regulators have seen positive benefits from their introduction on the speed of completing cases and ensuring public protection. The detail governing the operation of the proposals will require the GDC to amend the procedural rules governing their fitness to practice procedures. The GDC has consulted on its proposed rules changes and a negative procedure instrument will be laid in the Scottish Parliament this year. The Scottish Government considers that the best way to improve consistency, create greater efficiency and simplify professional healthcare regulation would be to introduce a single UK bill covering all professional groups, which builds on the work of the Law Commissions. I've written to the Department of Health on five separate occasions to ask for confirmation that such a bill is to be progressed, and I understand that I'll now finally receive a response in the near future. So I'm happy at this stage, Convener, to answer any questions that members may have.
Thanks to the Cabinet Secretary for those opening statements. Members, any questions? I see Dennis Robertson.
Again, Cabinet Secretary. Case examiners, what training will the case examiners have? And what will be, what's in place to ensure that they have the competence to meet the standards that you've laid down?
Jason, do you want to answer?
The case examiners will be given full training by the GDC. We've been reassured on that point. And there'll be a case review team which monitors our performance as the work progresses.
What length of experience will case examiners have before they can become a case examiner?
Well, of the case examiners, there'll be one registrant and one layperson. And in terms of the detail of that, that will be the GDC's guidance, which will be put into the rules in due course. So we don't have the absolute detail, but it will be substantial. We've been reassured.
That's fine. Thank you very much. Thanks.
Nanette Millen.
Ask, will this change actually bring the GDC into line with the GMC and the other regulating bodies that you've already mentioned? And how long is it since these other bodies did change their regulations?
Yeah, I mean, it will. It will bring more of a consistency of approach. And you know, I think the other regulators have moved in that direction for the same reason, in order to have a more efficient process. I think it's been over a number of years that the others, the GMC have had that for quite some time. I'm not sure about the exact dates, but for quite some time, and it's operated well.
Yeah, I mean, I thought it had been for some time. That's why I was asking you to check.
Yeah.
And if it has operated well, I mean, I think it's a very good idea if all these professional bodies do come into line as far as regulations concerned.
Yeah. Yeah.
And across the country, I have to say.
Malcolm Chisholm.
I'm sure everybody supports this. I mean, I suppose it's just interesting, I suppose, from the point of view of what things that we formally regulate and what things the UK formally regulates. So, I mean, are the processes absolutely identical to take, for example, for a dentist and a dental technician? And just in terms of the wording of this order, is that identical as well with the equivalent UK order?
Yes, it is.
The regulations UK-wide for all groups regulated by the General Dental Council.
But the regulations UK-wide, but has to be approved by us for certain of the groups. Is that the procedure?
Yes, and it'll be the same for Welsh and Northern Irish Assembly.
There's four groups regulated by the GDC: dental nurses, dental orthodontic therapists, clinical dental technicians, and dental technicians. Because they were regulated since the Scotland Act 1998, then the approval of Scottish Parliament is required. For any legislation which includes that.
So that's how it's done. It's more like, it's not formally a legislative consent, but it's like that. Is that what you're saying? You've agreed that it should be done at the UK level, but we have...
That's it,
We have, but we have to lay separate regulations.
No, the regulations are consistent UK-wide. It's just because they mention those four groups, then the Scottish Parliament needs to be content... for the registration. The
so it's actually more like a legislative consent.
In essence, yes, it's very similar to that.
No, okay, well, that's interesting. Okay, I thought we had to lay separate
regulations. No, it's just one set of regulations UK-wide.
Okay, no other questions? No other questions, then we move to agenda item number 5, which is a formal debate on the affirmative SSI, on which we have just taken evidence. Can I remind you all that members should not put questions to the Minister during this formal debate. And officials, of course, cannot take part in the debate. Can I invite the Minister to move motion S4M14970?
Moved.
Thank you. Do any members wish to participate in the debate? No members wish to participate in the debate. Minister, I don't presume you wish to add anything, but if you do... I therefore put the question on the motion. The question is that the motion S4M14970 be approved. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. We just suspend at this point. I pause to change the panel. Thank you very much. The sixth item on our agenda today is our second and final evidence session of the Draft Budget 2016-17. Can I welcome again for this session the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Wellbeing and Sport and her officials, Paul Gray, Chief Executive, NHS Scotland and Director General Health and Social Care. Welcome. And Dr. Catherine Calderwood, Chief Medical Officer. John Matheson, Director of Health Finance, eHealth and Analytics, all of the Scottish Government. Welcome to you all this morning, and a good new year to you all in our first session. We're moving directly to questions, which the first question, I think, is from Malcolm Chisholm.
I think we have a particular interest in the integration authorities and the funding of them, so everybody was obviously pleased about the announcement of the £250 million for social care. But I suppose questions have been asked about how that will work in practice. So I suppose the first question is how can you be sure that £250 million will actually be spent on social care.
Okay. Well, obviously, I'm aware you've raised this issue already in the chamber, and I was able to give a brief response to you to reassure you that we are very, very clear of our intentions that $250 million needs to be able to make a significant step change and improvement to the delivery of social care. So boards are very clear, and we're very clear with boards that first of all, that resource will be allocated to the IJBs. Obviously, Highland, the lead agency model is slightly different, but in terms of the other 31 IJBs. Discussions are ongoing, as you'll be aware, between John Swinney and COSLA in terms of the detail of the deal. But we are clear that we want that resource to deliver as much additional benefit as possible for social care. The benefit to the health service is also very important, and that's why this move has wide support, because although we've already invested the $100 million over 3 years to tackle delayed discharge, this size of injection of resource into social care has the ability to deliver a real change in terms of the progress in eradicating delayed discharge, but also to build some new models of delivery of social care, to anticipate the growing demographic changes that we have, and to make sure that through those, the new world of integration, that we have resources at a level that can begin to meet the demands that are out there. So, you know, I suppose we're in a phase at the moment where negotiations are still ongoing. What I am happy to do is to keep the committee informed once those are concluded in terms of some of the mechanics around how that resource will be delivered. But, you know, what I can say is that certainly from my position as the Cabinet Secretary for Health, I'm very clear that we must see that resource work to create a step change in the delivery of social care.
I mean, I suppose it's related, the concern, to the Audit Scotland report, with which you'll be familiar, the recent one about the integration, and Audit Scotland said, I quote, there is a risk that if NHS boards and councils seek to protect services that remain fully under their control, integration authorities may face a disproportionate reduction in their funding despite the focus on outcomes that all partners should have. So I suppose it's just trying to think in practice how this will work, so we can accept the $250 million will go to the IJBs, but since we don't know what the main sums are, as it were, that haven't yet been agreed between NHS boards and local authorities about how much is to go into the IJBs, and Audit Scotland has reflected that concern in its report, encapsulated by that quote, in terms of there may be a tendency not to give as much money as they should to the IJBs. It's just difficult to see that you can be confident that there will actually be the additional investment which you clearly want in social care. I don't know how you can ensure it happens. We hope it will happen, but I don't know how you can ensure it will happen, particularly from the local authority side, I suppose.
Okay, well, I mean, bear in mind, we're only in the shadow year of IGBs, and essentially they will have their first full year of operation come next April. And I think the answer really is to make sure that there's visibility and transparency for both local authorities and boards around the resources. Well, first of all, around the resources that go in to the integrated joint boards, but also what the outcomes are, and that, you know, with With integration and the legislation and requirements comes a responsibility to very clearly set out, not least to the public, that those two key organisations serve within their localities, to set out to the public what those plans are, what the outcomes are going to be from the resource that they're investing, what the priorities are for the collective resource that will be invested, and then to be held to account for the delivery of those outcomes. Now, as the Scottish Government, we have a responsibility to performance manage the NHS and make sure that they play their part in that. But, you know, I think there's also an onus on local government to be seen to be playing their part as well. I mean, it is, you know, established by statute. There are certain requirements through that statute around the production of reports and so on and so forth. So there are a number of levers that can be used. But, you know, my expectation is that there is far more to be gained by both organisations making this work for their local populations. And we need to make sure that both are held to account for the delivery of that significant resource.
I'm sure others will want to pursue that. Like, if I can just ask one other question about NRAC, because I was very concerned to see the extent to which certain health boards are that seem to have been moving towards parity are now moving away. Obviously, I've got a particular interest in Lothian, but I'm sure Dennis beside me will have an interest in Grampian. So Lothian, for example, will be in itself 30 million from parity based on the allocations for next year. So, and that's the total sum of money that you've set aside for NRAC parity, I think, next year. So how do you see this? That obviously creates particular problems for boards like Lothian's. And I just wonder what's your sort of plan now for NRAC parity? Does that mean it's going to take longer than you thought? Or, you know, why would you not consider trying to at least bring all the boards within the 1%, which I think was your original target, whereas I don't think the 30 million will bring all the boards within 1% of parity.
Okay, well, obviously NRAC is a process over a number of years, but the position of, well, there's obviously three main gainers from NRAC in 2016-17, but the two big gainers are Lothian and Grampian, which will actually receive more resource than they'd actually budgeted for. And I'll let John come in some of the detail in a minute. As I understand, the uplift to Lothian is at 6.4% and Grampian 6.6%. So, you know, it is they're significant gainers in 2016-17 through the NRAC formula. In terms of the 1%, that would bring Lothian, for example, to just 1.4%. So, you know, just slightly above the 1%, but nevertheless, you know, I think it's fair to say that Lothian and Grampian have, and Grampian in particular, have received resources beyond what they had budgeted to receive in 16-17. John, do you want to say a little bit more?
Just a couple of further comments. Over the last 5 years, we've put a cumulative total of 619 million into moving boards towards NRAC parity. And the principle that was established at the very beginning when we started this process was that we would do it in a way that didn't destabilise the boards that were on the other side of parity. And a particular focus there on Greater Glasgow and Clyde, which is the one board that is obviously in that position. So we're trying to do it in a measured way. The move to within 1%, and both Lothian and Grampian will be 1.4%, 1.5% after this adjustment. We accelerated that from, it was due to happen in 16-17, and we brought it forward into 15-16. Lothian were anticipating within their financial planning 12 million, they've got 14 million. Grampian were anticipating around about 10 million, and they've got 15 million. So they've got more than they were anticipating in their plan. But So we're trying to do it in a measured way. We're trying to do it in a way that doesn't destabilise the other boards in Scotland, and particularly Glasgow, and £619 million invested over the last 5 years. But we do accept the point that Lothian and Grampian are the two boards that are still round about 1% away from parity, and the focus will be going forward on those two boards.
OK, I'll leave it just now. Thanks.
Thank you. I've got Bob Doris next.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, everyone. Cabinet Secretary will know that I've got an interest in relation to the funding available for GPs, and I've pursued that matter locally in Glasgow as well. Can I welcome, first of all, that looking at the draft budget that we have before us, that there's a 3.6% increase in the general medical services budget for GPs, and that represents a 1.9% real terms increase. It's also worth putting on the record that that doesn't include another £45 million, which has been allocated to the new primary care fund that can be accessed by GPs and health practices for new ways of working. So you end up with a substantial increase in funds there. I think getting to something like 10% if you add that together. Sometimes there's a feeling that some of the issues surrounding GPs' practices is as much about recruitment and retention as it is about the funds available and new ways of working. I've got a particular interest, obviously, in urban areas and deprived areas, but other MSPs will have their own issues across Scotland. So there's a good uplift for GP services. I think what we're keen to know is what influence the Scottish Government can have on that in relation to taking some of the burden off some GP practices that are facing challenges that the Cabinet Secretary will be aware of, and how that feeds into recruitment and retention issues.
Okay. What we've tried to do through this budget is to prioritise areas of investment, which, you know, was not without its challenges, but hopefully the committee will see that whether it's the £250 million for social care or the additional investment in primary care and elective centres and so on, that we've tried to prioritise those areas of spend and that those align very much with the direction of travel for the NHS and health and care services generally. So in terms of primary care, there is a significant uplift, both in terms of the general medical services but also the primary care fund, which includes the £25 million of new funding, making a £45 million investment in 2016-17. I suppose it's then worth noting, though, that there are other significant budgets that lie elsewhere which also impact on primary care and will help to realise a new vision for primary care. So if you look at the Scottish Ambulance Service, investment, a good chunk of that is around working more closely with primary care. The health visitors investment again will have a significant impact on primary care, as will the social care budget as well. What we need to make sure is that all of that works to realise that new vision, and that we are able to make primary care an attractive proposition for the GPs of the future, so that we can encourage medical students to be choosing general practice as their preferred specialism, and that we also, through the very significant changes that will be made to the contract, and of course again these resources will help to underpin a new contract, and that work is obviously coming to fruition for the transition contract through 16-17, ready for the new contract from 2017. Again, I really, really want us to seize the opportunity to have tackling health inequalities as very much a focus of that new contract, and that the allocation formula needs to reflect that as well. Now, we're in the midst of negotiations and discussions around that, which haven't obviously been concluded as yet, but I hope that the significant investment in primary care will help to bring all of that to a positive conclusion, and that will in turn address the recruitment and retention issues, will help to deliver a more effective primary care service, and particularly will help to address some of the health inequalities that still exist within your constituency and many other constituencies.
That's helpful, and I don't want to push you too much when there's negotiations ongoing in relation to what you said. And as an urban MSP, I can accept there are areas of deprivation in remote and rural areas that have their own specific problems, but obviously in areas that I represent where there's significant urban deprivation, I'm delighted to hear there's more thought given to tackling those health inequalities that extend from that deprivation. But we have to have the GPs that want to work in those practices, of course, and one of the ways to get buy-in from a new generation of GPs is that they see themselves as very close partners in relation to health and social care integration, because with that £250 million and other monies, that's where the real meaty uplift is. So can you give us some reassurances that GPs and GPs practices are central to that health and social care integration? Because sometimes I think we're not too good at talking up what the opportunities are in relation to general practice going forward, and that in itself can dissuade a lot of young medics from choosing general practice as an option. So what would you say to those that are seeking to consider going for thinking about going on a training rotation to be a GP just now? Do they have a significant role to play in relation to health and social care integration? Because that's where the meaty uplift of cash certainly is.
Oh, absolutely. And of course, the RCGP and other bodies, the RCN and others, have frequently called for an investment in social care, because I think they recognise that all of it hangs together in terms of community services, and having the ability to pull those resources together for their patients, whether it's someone needing a care package or avoiding admission to hospital, being able to maintain people at home with chronic conditions. I mean, it's all part of the same picture. What we need to do, though, is to make sure that the frameworks and the structures that lie behind all of this can help deliver that new vision. There have been challenges in making sure that, for example, GPs are represented around the table of IGBs, and that's work in progress, to be honest. But we are very keen to make sure that that voice is not just heard, but is central to being able to be part of the decision-making about how resources are allocated, how the services are delivered and developed. And that is crucial. If we, you know, the vision, if we think to the next 5 to 10 years, it really has to be a significant acceleration of the shifting of the balance of care, something we've talked about, and I've talked about at this committee on a number of occasions, but really we need to accelerate the pace of that. I think this budget and the resources around this budget put down a marker that we really, that's where we need to head. The resources are following that, and we need to see that accelerated, and that's our commitment. Yeah.
Final question in relation to that. You mentioned shifting the balance of care. Obviously, I've mentioned before at committee about the £200 million in relation to the six new surgical centres the Scottish Government is seeking to develop across Scotland because of an ageing population, and we need to do those elective surgeries for whether it's hip replacements or cataracts or whatever. Now, that then falls in budgetary terms into the acute sector, and it can appear as if it's sucking resources towards the acute sector. Now, just coincidentally, my father-in-law is in the Golden Jubilee for a hip replacement this morning. Hope he doesn't mind me saying that. I didn't clear it with him first, but he is. But it allows him to stay at home. It allows him to continue to go on with what he's doing. So sometimes I don't think we're very good at identifying which spend is purely acute and which spend is actually an investment to keep people in the community for longer at home or in a homely setting. So when we do our budget scrutiny and we look at that £200 million, should we view that as a dragging of more money to the acute sector? Or how should we view it? Because some have done that, but obviously I would see it differently, but how would the Scottish Government seek to view that expenditure?
Okay, well, I hope it goes well for him this morning at the Golden Jubilee, and he's in good hands. I guess, well, bear in mind that £200 million is over 5 years. So if you compare that with a £250 million injection to social care in 16-17 alone, I think it's pretty clear where that there, you know, is a significant shift on the balance of care. However, we also need to make acute services more effective and efficient. If you look at the demands that are coming down the line, you've just articulated them around, you know, hips, knees and eyes. You could argue that those are preventive measures. I think they are, if we're avoiding people falling because their eyesight is failing, because they're not getting their cataracts sorted early enough, and so on and so forth. But there is also something around the more effective delivery of acute services per se, and that's going to require us to be able to avoid as many interruptions to planned procedures, which happen at the moment because emergencies come in, and that separation between elective and emergency procedures will mean a more effective and efficient flow of patients through procedures with less cancellations and being able to meet the demands of the future. So, you know, whereas the shift in the balance of care is absolutely key and important, we also need to make sure our acute services operate in the most effective and efficient manner that they can. And the Golden Jubilee model, I think, has proven itself to be a very effective and efficient way of doing high volume, high demand procedures, and what we want to do is to replicate that model throughout Scotland, and I think that's a good investment to make.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. I think this committee would welcome that. I think we've made comment on the pressure that targets place and the distortion sometimes of targets. So actually allocating money, making more efficiently, making more better use of that, I suppose is, you know, at least the least we can do to tackle that area. But there is another issue that you may want to respond to about the continual question that the committee have asked in its recent report about the continual use of some of these targets. That yes, of course, it keeps Bob's poor father-in-law at home for a week or so. But you know, having that operation today or a fortnight from today is not going to make much difference to him, I don't suppose. And maybe,
I'm sorry, I mentioned
him. Well, you did, and you mentioned them the last time. It's a habit some of you have but you did that. But there is an issue there, and I think the targets that we have and the target regime that we have is not replicated in some of the other areas that you have mentioned about the reductions in deprivation, the reductions in inequalities, etc., etc. We've seen that with, was it over £100 million? It was put into A&E when the crisis was running there. But you know, those of us who support the progress and the journey that you're on are sometimes stumped with some of the spending announcements we make in the short term to deal with A&E, when in the longer term planning and these resources. We raised this issue about the £200 million and the A&E services, around £300 million over a period of time conceded, with some of the people last week who are being given a responsibility to transform how we provide health and social care. Those who are heading up the integrated joint boards, they told us last week that they haven't agreed their budgets with the health service. We now know that £250 million, we don't know exactly how that will be fed into them or whether that will be a real opportunity for them. If these organisations are going to be the standard bearers of this step change, should they not know what their budgets are in January for April? How do you plan in that environment? How do we give them the best assistance?
Well, they will, first of all, just to reassure you, they will all have their budgets in place and their plans in place well before they hit the ground running in April. And I suppose some of it is, you know, this is new territory. It's new ways of working. Sometimes that can be difficult. It's no surprise to you, Convener, and I'm sure that those partnerships that were already quite strong have got on with the job. In other areas where that relationship maybe wasn't as well developed, it's maybe been more challenging. And I suppose that's as ever the case. However, if you look, for example, at what's been delivered in places like Glasgow City, for example, a relationship between the council and the health board that perhaps wasn't traditionally one of the strongest has actually managed to deliver one of the best results in terms of the reduction in those delayed discharges for the over 75s by a remarkable amount. And that's because of a number of things, but for example, the power and responsibility being devolved to the operational managers of both organisations so that they can get on and resolve issues and get on with the job without having to go back and get sign-off by, you know, 10 different committees and so on and so forth. Also, that within Glasgow, the ward staff within hospitals can directly commission social care, and I'm told that has made a huge difference in the speed of getting people discharged. They're also developing a range of services to avoid admission to hospital in the first place, so they're more developed around the step-up facilities within the City of Glasgow. So there are, it shows, the reason I'm citing that is it shows what can be done, and you know, they're almost able to name now the cases that are delayed within the City of Glasgow, which shows the how few those cases now are compared to previously. Now, other partnerships are not there yet in that territory, but they need to be, and if we can get all partnerships to be in that same territory and perhaps learn some of the lessons that have been deployed within the City of Glasgow, which I know is sometimes a challenge as well, to look at what's happening elsewhere, then I think we really can make a huge change, because the integration boards are really only as good as what they deliver, and that has to be a change and improvement to the services that people receive. You mentioned targets. I have said here before that as part of the discussion around the national conversation, as part of the discussion around the national clinical strategy, which Catherine has been working hard on along with Jason Leach and others, that, you know, we're up for a discussion about what are the right targets. I mean, interestingly, I would probably disagree around the unscheduled care, because actually, the investment in unscheduled care has meant that this winter, for example, touch wood so far, has been a big improvement on what we saw last winter. And from a patient safety perspective, it actually is much safer for people within A&E departments to be treated within the four-hour target, which is why it was set. And if you speak to the Royal College of Emergency Medicine, they will tell you that the four-hour target, if you were to pick a target, is actually, they will defend that very, very strongly, because it's actually a bit of a barometer of what's happening in the rest of the hospital. So yes, we should discuss targets in the round, but I think out of all of the targets, the investment made in unscheduled care has meant that the flow through the whole hospital has forced other parts of the hospital to get on with discharging patients, and has helped to create a culture of not holding on to patients, to get beds freed up, to get patients out, to get them home. And that's meant that the joining up with council colleagues has had a direct impact on the front door of the hospital, because people, the beds have been freed up much earlier. So we have to look at the whole system rather than just one part of it.
Yeah, I agree with that. I think anyone who sat in this committee over the last 5 years, you know, you agrees with that. That we'd probably argue that the solution in the A&E departments lies out with A&E departments, although it assists in the one. And who knows, we could be facetious and say the absence of snow and ice helps A&E departments meet their targets this year. There's many, many factors that are involved in there. But some of the evidence that we are having with, you know, with all of, you know, I can understand it. I think it's a good marker, as you described, a good marker that £250 million are being directed. There's no doubt about that. I think that if that's the start of something and a journey, then that's very good indeed. But what people are concerned about at that level, this separation in the health service and social care, although we all see them as integrated and not integrated in a whole, they're developing, it's been suggested, not working with, but parallel systems. Now, there is, I think, a danger in that. And some of the Glasgow work, I think, shows some of that. They're circumventing, you know, doctors' practice or hospital doctors' practice and things like that, rather than that integration to solve some of their problems. Now, if that develops in this way, that we're getting that parallel running, as some people are concerned about, how do we avoid that? How do we get that integration that we need to deliver, and the money going to the police is where it should be going, when at this stage, whether we like it or not, they haven't agreed their budgets?
Well, ultimately, it's down to accountability, visibility, transparency. All of that has to be laid out. So the partnerships have to be able to show how they have, well, first of all, how they've agreed their priorities, what those priorities are, how they've invested, what new services they've delivered and developed, and what the outcomes have been for their populations. All of that will be laid bare in terms of the reports that those partnerships will need to make through their IGBs. Now, of course, it's not just the two organisations, as well as the local authority and the NHS. There are the third sector partners, there's the private sector role around the table, That's important as well in terms of delivery partners. But, you know, I suppose the axis is really around the interface between the NHS and the local authority. I mean, the reason we had to legislate, as you know, convener, was because the pace of joint working wasn't cutting it. It wasn't delivering what we needed to deliver. Within the legislation, there are levers to help to ensure that things are delivered. But, you know, at the end of the day, I think we're already, as I said, by citing Glasgow, we're already beginning to see the fruits of that. Would all of that have happened without integration? I don't think it would. I think it's forced partners to really think about things in a different way, to have a collective responsibility for the resources that they spend within their locality, to think in more innovative ways. I think part of it is about trust as well. So, for example, trusting their operational managers to get on with the job of delivering the services that have been agreed are going to be delivered. And I think if I was to pick out one thing around the Glasgow success that perhaps is a lesson for others, it is about trusting the front line to get on with the job, rather than continually having to refer back to the parent host organisations. Now, that requires an element of, there's a bit of risk there, but it requires trust. But it has meant that operational managers within the City of Glasgow have been able to sort some of the inevitable glitches, issues that arise, have been able to identify what those are, agree what the solution is, and get on and sort it. And when I met with the operational managers within Glasgow from both organisations, they felt quite empowered to do that in a way that they hadn't been previously. Now, is that I'm not saying that is it's not a magic wand by any manner of means, but it appears to me to have been a significant factor in the success of getting those delayed discharge figures down in Glasgow in a way that is a bit of a standout.
I'm not going to go on, but we have had great examples, haven't we? I mean, Highland's been on a five-year journey, and we have had great examples given in evidence about your pockets of good practice, etc. But it hasn't been an outbreak. It hasn't been infectious. You know, we've had to legislate to make it happen. So we've got lots of examples I suppose what we are as a committee, you know, trying to provide some budget scrutiny here, in and around specific pockets of money that has been directed to tackle different areas. At the same time, we also know as a committee, looking at social care, that unless we get that aspect in local government delivering and working effectively, we can't achieve one without the other. And there's a big power gap between mean, it's sitting there in front of us in terms of the Cabinet Secretary for Health and all of the people here who are health board. It's health. They've got that place at the table. And you've got local government who are facing cuts and pressures and increased pressures on it. It's not an equal balance, and we're putting a lot of expectation on that part of the system to deliver effectively for us. And you know, there's a power relationship here. It's not in any way equal at all.
It is now one system, and it has to be one system. It has to see itself as one system. And you know, would 5 years ago, would we have invested £250 million a year into another part of the system? As we probably not.
Know if it's going into that
part
of the system.
Well, it will. I can assure you, it will. Boards have been. We've been very clear with boards that money will go to IJBs, and it will sit within those IJBs. That's quite groundbreaking. I mean, it's a significant resource. And you know, you can imagine that health boards, that's new territory for them as well. It's challenging, it's different. Mm-hmm. And it will mean thinking about things in a different way. It's not about that so-and-so's money. It's got to be now a very different thought process around that collective resource and making it work more effectively. The 250 million is a significant injection, but you know, really what they need to look at is that global resource that they are now collectively responsible for and making it work more effectively to deliver a better service for patients and service users within their area.
Dennis Roberts.
Maybe change direction slightly, Cabinet Secretary. Can I also say that Malcolm Wright in Grampian did put on record he welcomed the additional monies that was coming to Grampian, and there's a fantastic capital spend going on in Grampian as well. I think there's a lot of good news stories that we can actually take forward from Grampian. I wonder if you could... can I say that I welcome the additional monies for mental health, and I'm just wondering if you could maybe explain a little about how that money could be spent within the mental health programme. And in addition, what monies are going to be spent within the digital technology to enable sort of distance examinations of patients, for instance, to prevent them having to travel. So if I look at rural areas within my own constituency, and obviously in places like Orkney, that maybe require a specialism, that they can speak to a consultant in Aberdeen. So what investment is there? And you touched on the preventative spend in terms of the elective surgeries that's going on. Do we have an idea how much money, what we're actually saving by actually having cataracts done in terms of trips and falls? A lot of questions.
Well, on the last point first, that modelling has been done, and certainly we could probably get you some additional information from the work John Conaghan's done around, you know, if you invest, if you prevent falls, for example, by... effective preventative measures, which I think you could argue a cataract operation is, then yep. What does that save in terms of other parts of the system? There has been work carried out on that. I mean, in terms of, I'll answer the mental health issue, and then John Matheson can come in on the digital. On mental health, The top line around investment over the next 5 years will be £150 million of additional investment over that period. So that builds on the investment already announced by Jamie Hepburn around the £100 million with the focus on child and adolescent mental health services, bringing down waiting times there. Increased access to specialist services and psychological services, plus an investment in the field of primary care in mental health, because we know, for example, that many GP appointments are taken up with people who have mental health issues, and if we can provide more options for GPs to be able to refer to them, I think there's good compelling evidence that we can help to avoid perhaps some further more severe and enduring mental health issues further along the line. So work is going on around what that might look like. The additional 50 million was as a consequence of the consequentials received through the health budget from the UK government. We took the decision to allocate that 50 million to mental health, and we will be looking and discussing what the priorities for that should be over the next 5 years. I mean, I know there's been a significant interest in this place around
sure
investment
in
mental health, not least from yourself and others. And, you know, we absolutely are determined to make sure that we get that right. And it's getting the balance right of investment in specialist services, but also the requirement perhaps for, which is why I was keen to see some investment within the primary care ambit to try and prevent some of perhaps more enduring mental health challenges further down the line if we can have prevention and early intervention. So I'm happy as we develop those plans to keep the committee informed about the thinking of where that additional resource will be invested. John, do you want to talk about the digital investment?
I think just three examples here. The first one is we have put some recurring resource into this area. We put £10 million into this area in terms of technology-enabled care, and looking at how we can support people to live in their homes, but also picking up on your point around video conferencing, and rather than people coming down, travelling a long distance for a 20-minute outpatient follow-up, to be able to do it through a VC link. And following on from that, we have allocated to individual boards the Highlands and Islands Travel Scheme funding, which is about £15 million. And that's intended to allow boards to look at whether they can reduce the amount of air travel, ferry travel that they have for patients, and invest money in enhancing video conferencing facilities. So these are two examples there. We're also doing some very powerful work with European colleagues and learning from best practice and sharing our best practice with them, and looking at what's happening in Scandinavia in terms of the distance healthcare and how healthcare is provided, and also in Alaska. And the final example I would give is we have 8 innovation centres being taken forward within Scotland, and one of them is the Digital Health and Care Institute, which will be based at the Eurocentral at Maxim, in just outside Motherwell. And they're looking at developing a simulation laboratory, so a ward in a domestic environment, to allow SMEs to come in and take their products forward to market using a real-life environment. So European examples, innovation examples, plus also how we can use the Highlands and Islands Travel Scheme and the technology-enabled care money. So it's something that we're keen to proceed and proceed with at pace, because the ability to take that forward with the way technology is moving forward is greatly enhanced over the next few years.
Excellent. Thank you.
Malcolm, did you have a supplementary on the mental health?
I was wanting to ask about capital, but somebody
that's
else
okay
might.
Then. I'll let I thought it was mental health, so I'll move on to the next one, which is Nanette Millen.
A couple of comments first from me. I was very pleased to hear what you said about the empowerment of frontline staff, the success of that in the Glasgow area, because I think to give key frontline people your responsibility for what they're actually doing, and I think is one of the key issues in getting things right. The other thing what to refer back to is the funding. I hear what you say about tackling health inequalities, which is clearly very important, but I just worry, as someone from Grampian, given the long time it's taken to bring NHS Grampian near parity and under the NRAC formula, I do worry a little bit that we might suffer again in a new funding formula situation, which was more likely to put money away from Grampian and into basically the central area of Scotland, where I agree money is needed.
That's a comment. But what I really wanted to say was the RCN, I see in its written evidence to us, expresses a continuing concern about the presentation of the budget and a lack of any direct linkage between spending and priorities and outcomes. And also the lack of scrutiny of in-year allocation of resources. And they cite the six new elective treatment centres as part of that. Now, the BMA have also said to me that these treatment centres seem to just suddenly appear on the horizon. They weren't sure how or why, what the rationale was. Could you give us any sort of elucidation of that, please?
Okay. First of all, obviously, we've talked about Grampian being, receiving more of an allocation than they had budgeted for, and I think they seem pretty content with that. The other, when we talked earlier about the allocation formula, it was more in relation to the GP contract. These things are obviously open for debate, but I think really if we need to find a more systematic way of tackling health inequalities. And I want to try to move away from the kind of initiative here and initiative there approach. We have to make sure that it's built into the way that we do business. And one of the most effective tools is through a primary care intervention because of the community nature of the services. Now, if we can get that right through the new GP contract, I think we are on to something quite significant. There will be a debate around that, and as I say, we're in the midst of early negotiations, so there's not too much detail that can be said around that. But I, as the Cabinet Secretary, I'm very keen that we really take the opportunity to have a step change in the way that we are able to tackle health inequalities in our most deprived communities. On the issue of outcomes and in-year allocation, it hopefully won't have escaped your notice that we've actually listened to what the committee said around that, and instead of the 65 budget lines or whatever there was to boards, we're bundling that resource, and they will have far more flexibility in the way that they manage that resource. They'll still require to deliver outcomes, and we're working on an outcomes framework with boards, and Paul, can we say a bit more about that in a second? But it's with a view to having for boards to be able to deliver those outcomes in a more flexible way and make better use of the resources and avoid more of the in-year allocation that I know the committee had comment on. In terms of the elective centres and the RCN comment and others, the elective centre model has been well tested through the Golden Jubilee model. So what we wanted to do was to take the learning from that and to look at what's the best models would be to ensure we have the right level of diagnostic and treatment capacity within the NHS. The National Clinical Strategy, which again Catherine might want to say a bit more about, is an opportunity to discuss these matters further. But if something works and it's shown to work, and we know that the split between elective and emergency goes back to the CARE report, so it's not particularly anything new, it's about making it happen. And the rationale for the six was so that each area of Scotland had access to enough capacity that would make a difference to the way the acute services operate, to be able to meet the growing demands for the future, and that there was a geographical spread of that, because we know there have been challenges in perhaps areas further from the Golden Jubilee referring, and there are issues around that. So we felt it was important that we took the learning from that and applied it and came up with the model. There's still work going on about what will be where in terms of what procedures, and so there's still scope for discussion and engagement, and the best place to do that would be through the National Clinical Strategy. Do you want to say
Yeah. So on the outcomes framework, if you think of a effectively a, three parts, a local delivery plans, an outcomes framework and the clinical strategy, you see how we're trying to give a strategic framework within which the NHS and its delivery partners can operate. And the point about putting the outcomes framework alongside the local delivery plan as part of that process is, whereas we still want to be sure that that boards are operating within financial balance, we want to be certain that they are meeting the standards that we've set, subject to the discussion that this committee and others are having. Instead of having, as the Cabinet Secretary says, 65 separate lines of accounting, where you probably spend as much time accounting for what you've spent as you do on delivering what you ought to deliver, if we can set a frame of outcomes for the boards, which also take account of the fact that there is now a significant set of outcomes to be delivered by statute through the integrated joint boards, it seems to us more coherent to have it done that way than to do it through a series of separate little points of accountability. And Catherine Calderwood will say a little about where we're headed on the national clinical strategy, but I think the point is to ensure that clinical decision making remains central to the delivery of national health services. So of course there has to be proper financial management, of course there has to be proper administration, but leadership and clinical decision making I think are central to the delivery of safe, person-centred and effective services to patients. So perhaps the CMO could say something about the clinical strategy.
And I'll start, I suppose, with the elective centre example. So the Golden Jubilee currently performs 25% of hip and knee replacements, the major joint replacements for the whole of Scotland. So Mr. Doris's father-in-law is in a place with a very high volume. If you look then at the National Hip Registry, which Scotland has run for many years, the outcomes for those hip replacements are the best in the country. So infection rate, operative complications, readmission rate are way above the line for being very, very good. So we've got a model of a high volume centre doing very, very high quality work with, of course, the best outcomes, which is what we're aiming for. So I think that is a driver behind some of the national clinical strategy work. If we looked at the converse, we then have redo surgery, and that will take knee replacements, again, high volume. There is always a volume of people who will need another knee or another hip because it wears out. We have then smaller numbers, but they are done spread out across the country. And we know that that is not the best, doesn't produce the best outcome. If a surgeon does more of these, particularly the complicated ones, the outcome for the patient is better. So the National Clinical Strategy is building on some of this medical evidence that we have for volume, but also you're then being able to deliver your rehabilitation closer to home. So that's where our integration and the primary care part and hospital at home, etc., comes into play. So we're asking those questions very much in that National Clinical Strategy about, well, if we line up what we know, operative procedures are probably easier to benchmark because they have known complication rate, known redo surgery rate. If you take a particular volume that we know gives a better outcome for the patient, well, why aren't we delivering that all over Scotland? So we're asking once for Scotland type questions. It might be six times for Scotland for these elective work, but we're starting in that strategy to say we know that there is evidence. Why are we not moving towards a system where that those outcomes for patients are lined up as the very top line? There's always interpretation, and there are, of course, financial issues to all of that, but can we then have a pragmatic solution where the value for money, of course, is important, and but the clinical drivers are always key behind. You have to remember the rurality and the travel time, and for certain people, a long distance to travel might be for them, if it's every week for chemotherapy, maybe that's the wrong thing for elderly patients. But you're looking for a solution that will be clinically focused and patient focused. And I think our strategy, it's going to ask some uncomfortable questions. It's going to have some uncomfortable conversations with the medical and nursing professionals as well, because people hold on to their patch. And if you're very keen on doing a particular procedure, you may not want that procedure to be done somewhere else if you're doing a low volume. Those are not going to rest easy in everybody's committee meetings. But I think if we keep saying, well, if that's the best outcome for the patient, then we have to go get past these difficult situations.
Convener, I mean, I have to say I don't disagree with anything that's just been said. I think it makes an awful lot of sense. I just wonder, is there therefore some sort of communication difficulty? Because, I mean, to have an organisation like the RCN and the BMA sort of planning, well, we didn't know about this. And I think nothing against these elective treatment centres. I don't know they would have either. But I just wonder, that it seemed to just suddenly appear as far as they're concerned, and I wonder if that's right or if there's a failure of communication somewhere. I don't know.
I mean, I have an ongoing dialogue with the BMA and the RCN and others, and we discuss a whole multitude of issues. I mean, I would like to think that there's a pretty broad consensus of the need to build in capacity, the right capacity in the right places. And, you know, for doctors and nurses and other health professionals in Tayside and Grampian and in Lothian, I and of course Highland, Raigmore would be one as well. I think there is a welcoming of the concept. Where there's room for discussion still is about what's going to be done where, and there's still, you know, it was really about establishing the principle. We think this is a good model. We want to do more of it. We think these are the places that would benefit from that additional capacity and separation from emergency procedures. And, you know, we're now in the position through the National Clinical Strategy of discussing, well, what would we want to do? Because we might not want to do hips, knees and eyes at every centre. Some centres might become the centre for X, Y, or Z. And I think these are the areas that we need to discuss. Plus, anticipating what the demand is going to be for these procedures into the future, and making sure that we have the right capacity in the right places to help meet that demand.
As some of those difficult discussions being around issues like how we sustain consultant-led A&E services, well, at the number that we're currently doing so, because I think, you know, going back in memory, you know, one of the issues about which was derogatively described as a centralisation system, but better described by Dr. Calderwood as getting good quality outcomes, by people who are doing thousands of these knee operations a year, your chances are better. But what was the worry in terms of, you know, A&E and that the impact when you withdraw some of these services from some of the local hospitals, then you diminish your opportunity to provide a 7-day, 24-hour consultant-led A&E service at some of these hospitals?
So, I mean, when you... Obviously, the National Clinical Strategy hasn't been published yet, and it will be in due course. But actually, what the model is more around being able to sustain our district general hospitals with a range of core services, if you like, that you would expect to see in your local hospital, which would include your front door, your hospital, your A&E services, and there obviously has to be a level of service that lies behind that in order to deliver a safe and sustainable service. So that would be your kind of core services. What we are talking about here is really those services that are more specialist in nature, or where there is a clear evidence that doing very low volumes of them is probably not the safest. So if you look at vascular services, for example, there's good evidence around vascular services that that the outcomes for patients are better where there are specialist centres. So it's really being, it's looking at that distinction of what are general core services that people could expect to receive at their local hospital, and what are the more specialist services where, you know, you may have one in a lifetime, or, you know, but it is better, the outcomes for patients in terms of patient safety show that actually they're better delivered in a centre, a regional centre or a national centre. So these are the, and you know, none of that is fixed in tablets of stone. These are debates to be had, but there is a clinical evidence base for, or an emerging clinical evidence base for that. It's not things that are plucked out of thin air. It is what is, you know, based around the clinical evidence, and getting that distinction between, you know, what local hospitals will continue to provide, which will be the services that most people receive most of the time, compared to those once, twice in a lifetime services, which, you know, are not the services that people would expect to receive every day.
Does it make it more possible for 7-day working with development?
I would say so. Again, if you look at the, and Catherine will be able to say a bit more about this, but if you look at how those services could be configured, I think it does. There's obviously challenges to be overcome around making sure that we get the right definition of what we mean by 7-day services. What we're not doing is what they've done down in England and given a perception that, you know, what we're talking about is everything being able to be done 24/7. That's just not realistic. Just because you could do a procedure in the middle of the night, it doesn't mean it's the right or the safest thing to do. What we're talking about is making sure that that services that you would expect to see, or that are required to be delivered over 7 days, are done so in a safe and consistent manner, and that the Ones for Scotland approach is taken to make sure that diagnostics are available, for example, at the weekend, because we know if they are, you can then have more of a chance of getting someone discharged more quickly. So it all is part of the same picture of more efficient, effective services. And actually, in some parts of the country, they've already developed, for example, in Glasgow, the diagnostic procedures over the weekend. Do you want to say a wee bit?
Just a second. Just if we could maybe tail back to the budget implications.
Sorry.
Of some of that 7-day. Has that been factored in the budget, that sort of progression? Is that part of the 200?
It's part of the 13 billion, if you like, convener. Right, so. I mean, the sustainable 7-day working group has been working for some time around what is required to deliver safe, sustainable services over 7 days. They have produced their interim report. That's all been factored into, you know, making sure that boards in their allocations and indeed their outcome framework, which Paul touched on earlier on, are delivering the services in the right places in the right way that they need to, in order to deliver the right services over 7 days, which is not it's not all singing, all dancing 24/7 for everything. That's not what we mean by 7-day services. What it is, though, is around making sure that there are safe, consistent services, particularly over the weekends and evenings, that need to be provided, particularly in the area of diagnostics.
I think that, and the National Clinical Strategy will also talk about doing things differently. So we talk about the example of the virtual fracture clinic in Glasgow, which has reduced the number of patients returning to be seen by an orthopaedic surgeon by 38%. So instead of everybody who's seen through A&E having their X-ray done, they all just used to come back because there wasn't a consultant there 24/7. Instead, the consultant looks, and this is some of the digital technology, accesses the films virtually, not with the patient at all. A nurse phones the patient to check if there are details needing to be checked with symptoms. 38% of the patients no longer come back, and that has freed up 10% of each consultant orthopaedic surgeon in GRI's time. So you're actually using that time in their week in a different way to provide a more consistent service throughout the week. So in fact, some of the ways of working, if you work differently, the 7 days is not, in fact, needing additional resource. You can do it and still have a saving. So I think we're talking, I suppose, about re-examining what, because you'll maybe not be surprised to hear that there hasn't been an outbreak of virtual fracture clinics all over Scotland. We need the orthopaedic people to talk to each other. It's spread outside Glasgow, in fact, not at the moment across all of Glasgow. So I think that this conversation very much needs to happen, because initially orthopaedic surgeons said, well, this is a disaster. We won't see the patients. We'll miss all these fractures. There'll be all sorts of adverse outcomes. And of course there aren't, if it's done in a very robust way. So some of this is about the culture change and about reassuring people that working differently can be, in fact, better for the patients, but doesn't then lead to less good outcomes in the, you know, for their fractures, etc., in the future.
Richard Lyle.
To a hospital, as I had to do during the new year, you look up the signs and you see all the different services that are being provided. Last year, our budget for health reached 12 billion. This year, our budget, and I compliment you on it, that your budget is going to reach 13 billion. The territorial boards and the special boards are going to get nearly over 500 million more, plus the other factors. But can I go slightly off message for a second? This is one third of your budget is spent in health. But what I want to, since I've got the opportunity and I can't pass it up, we're shortly going to be doing an inquiry into the Penrose, a discussion of the Penrose inquiry. As we all know, the blood products disaster, which has resulted in people possibly going to make substantial claims on budgets. Now, is it on the individual health budget of a board, or is it against the health system? You know, Mr. Gray or Mr. Matheson may want to enlighten me. Are we insured for that? My view is that it possibly could reach in between, and I may be picking figures out there that people may dispute, something like 50 million or more for Scotland alone. So what are we doing to, you know, I don't see it in this budget at all, and I'm sure it won't be, but suddenly we'll pick this money out there. Where's it going to come from? Can I be enlightened in regards to that?
Well, I'll let John say a word about litigation and how the NHS handles that more generally in a second. But on the positive side, I mean, we've just received just before Christmas received the report from the group that was set up under Ian Welsh's chairmanship to review and make recommendations around the financial provisions for people who have been affected through contaminated blood and blood products. Now, that series of recommendations are quite far-reaching. They would substantially enhance both the payments made to people in terms of the one-off payments made to people at stage one of illness, but also substantially enhance the ongoing payments for people who have got the highest health needs. And there are other supports for widows, and there are supports in terms of one-off hardship payments and so on. So as a package, it is a very substantial package. Resources have been set aside within the budget to meet the needs of those affected. And at the moment, I'm considering those recommendations, and I'll be making an announcement in due course about those. But, you know, just to put on the record, as I have done previously, you know, I'm absolutely determined to make sure that some of the hardships that, you know, I've been told about very directly from those affected and their families, that we provide a better level of support to people in Scotland. Obviously, what happens elsewhere, I'm not responsible for, but I'm determined to make those improvements here in Scotland. In terms of litigation and court cases, I mean, there already have been some around this area, but John, do you want to say a word?
I mean, just a couple of things. So we have a general clinical negligence insurance scheme, and that primarily is used for obstetric and gynae cases, tend to be the prime examples that come through that. And that money is allocated to boards, and they pay a premium to recognise that. And what I've done in my almost 8 years in this role now is I've moved from the traditional position where there was a lump sum payment made, and they moved to a position whereby there's now a reduced lump sum made for housing adaptations, transport adaptations, and then there's an annual payment made for the lifetime of the individual who's been affected. But the key factor there, as well as the dealing with the cost of the legal claim, is to learn lessons from a clinical practice to make sure that the situation that caused these tragic events where the NHS has been negligent, and we've accepted that we've been negligent, that we reduce the chances of these happening again. In terms of the infected blood patients, we have been making some payments to date in parallel with England, and as Cabinet Secretary has said, we have recognised on a central basis, not in terms of the board allocations, there will be a central sum may set aside to recognise the cost of this going forward.
How much is that central sum?
I don't know if the fund top of it. And the problem is we haven't concluded the negotiations.
So
it could be inappropriate to...
Well, I'm looking at the recommendations, so obviously if I accept the recommendations, the resources will be made available to meet those recommendations. But, you know, John Matheson's made an important point. There's already been around £30 million paid to Skipton and, goodness, the other fund. The two funds, because they're done on a UK basis and we pay our share for Scottish recipients into that fund, and there's already been around £30 million paid through that route.
So lastly, if you allow me, Convener, the point I was trying to make, and thank you very much, and I know you have been working hard on this issue, as I have in the last couple of years. So I'll be assured that, or the people can be assured that any funding that is required will be made available.
I certainly want to recognise the work that you've done, Richard, on this area, and as have the campaigners. I mean, when I was first on this committee, it was one of the earliest issues we looked at. It's been a long-standing issue. Now, you know, what the recommendations are the recommendations of that the group have come together on a basis of compromise. I'm not going to sit here and say everybody is happy with them, but they are, they've been born out of a pragmatic discussions that have taken place within, led by people affected, and those are the recommendations that have emerged. And as I say, they're with me now. And if those recommendations are accepted, we will absolutely make sure the resources are there to meet them.
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Malcolm Chisholm. Is any of the members who haven't asked a question wish to come back? You've been in though. I'll let you back in. Sure. Malcolm Chisholm.
I just wanted to get to the bottom of the capital budget, which is of course very interesting because of all the things that have been happening. But, I mean, firstly, well, there's a big increase in it, but a large part of that is this £215 million upfront capital to provide cover for the NPD projects. I mean, I suppose you can't really say definitely, but would you still be hopeful that that money will not be required, and that changes can be made to those projects to kind of take them off the balance sheet, or is that an unrealistic hope at this stage?
I mean, it's difficult to say because obviously John Swinney is leading on this. He's in very close discussion with the Treasury. Obviously, this has been triggered through ONS and Eurostat, and he's, you know, still in the midst of all of that. Obviously, the decision that was made on the Aberdeen peripheral route has significant implications. But you, John, do you want to say a little bit about the rationale in terms of the cover?
I think there's two different aspects here. There were two things conjoined at the beginning. One was the MPD projects, such as the Aberdeen peripheral bypass, and the second one was the hub projects. And there was concern about a number of the hub projects being caught up in this. We've now had clarity from the Office of National Statistics that the hub contract is acceptable to them, and they were able now to proceed with projects such as the Greenock and the Inverclyde Health Centres and other projects that were held up by that. The MPD position, they've given us a view on the Aberdeen project, and they haven't specifically given a view on any of the health projects, but the expectation, the current shape of the contract, is their view would be similar to the Aberdeen one, so we would need capital cover. So that's what we're prudently covering at the moment. We will continue to pursue on a Scottish Government basis, working with Scottish Futures Trust, whether there is any adaptations we can do to the MPD contract that would make it compliant and revert back to a similar situation to hub. So this is a prudent position at this point in time, and this will enable the five MPD projects, Sick Children's, Dumfries and Galloway, the Blood Transfusion Centre, Ayrshire and Arran, and the Balfour Hospital placement up in Orkney to proceed.
So in terms of the hub projects, I mean, we don't really need to go into the details of the changes that have been made, but are there any budgetary implications from the changes that have been made to the hub projects, or are there not?
There are not.
There are not, okay. And even apart from the NPD, the cover, the 250 million, there seems to be an increase in the capital budget, which we would welcome. I mean, I don't know if you can say more about that. Obviously, that's been something that's run in the past, that the capital budget has not been increased, and I suppose that a lot of that's because it's been funded through the NPD method. So I'm not objecting when I ask why is there still an increase there on the capital budget. And I suppose if you add the natural increase plus the cover, it's a very substantial increase in the capital budget. And I suppose the other question is, what are the implications of that for, I suppose, other parts, you know, the capital programme more generally, either health or the Scottish Government more generally, or are we just able to have a bigger increase in the capital programme because of our new borrowing powers?
It's not specifically connected to the new borrowing powers. If you put the 215 million for NPD to one side, the other major areas of increase have been an additional 50 million coming into capital. And what that has enabled us to do is it's enabled us to remove the resource, because as you mentioned, Mr. Chisholm, the capital position has generally been tight across the Scottish Government, and health is no different from that. So as part of our financial modelling for 16-17, we were anticipating having to transfer £47.5 million from resource to capital to give us an adequate capital budget to take forward to do the work on backlog maintenance, the work on non-MPD projects. So the additional 50 million that we've got as part of the draft budget settlement has enabled us to remove that resource to capital transfer and has enabled us to proceed with the £250 million into social care, etc. In addition to that, we got an additional £23.5 million for the diagnostic and the treatment centres. And that will partly be spent on that, but will also be spent on the investing in taking forward the cancer plan.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you. The next one I've got on my list is Dennis Robertson, and then Bob Dorris, I think.
Hey, thank you, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, is there a budget allocation for the community pharmacies to take on minor ailments in order that to sort of prevent people going to their GPs, for instance? And if so, what sum of money is that? And is there money in terms of raising the awareness in terms of educating our the public in terms of using community pharmacies in a better way than maybe we currently do at the moment?
Well, there obviously is an allocation around the pharmacy contract, and that's part of an ongoing negotiation at the moment, as well as the other contractors will be. But as part of the primary care fund, there is an element within that, you may recall, to increase the number of pharmacists attached to primary care premises. So doing a lot of the medicines reconciliation work, really trying to help relieve some of the workload of GPs, but also bringing their specialist skills to manage medicines within the patient population within that locality in a better, more effective way. I mean, the role of community pharmacy more generally within the vision for primary care is very important as we take forward the concept of the multidisciplinary team, the community hub model, where patients are going to see the most appropriate health professional. In many cases, that will be the community pharmacist. We know that there are there is a lot of interest within people studying pharmacy who want to do more of the clinical pharmacy role, and we want to create those opportunities for them to do so. So that will mean far more patient-facing work, again, you know, it is part of that new multidisciplinary model that community pharmacies, which are very accessible in terms of 7-day working as well, they're open, they're accessible, they're well located, often, you know, have a significant role to play. So that, you know, the budget supports that, but it also provides additional resources through the primary care fund to really be pushing at the boundaries of that and making sure that we're both ensuring the community pharmacy has a continuing role, but also that we have the skills of those pharmacists attached to GP practices in order to reduce the workload of GPs and to, as part of making primary care a more attractive proposition.
Are you able to determine how well it's being used in terms of patients using the pharmacist as opposed to going to their GP practice?
I mean, we can certainly get you more information on that, but yes, the evidence is that patients they like using their community pharmacist for a start, that they get a good service through the minor ailment service and through the chronic medication. Yep. And that actually, particularly for people with chronic conditions and for the elderly population, it's a good, well-regarded service. It's actually very cost-efficient as well. What we want to do, though, is to build on that and to make that more of the mainstream way people receive their community health services, so that there will be a more systematic way of accessing community health services that will mean that you don't always see a doctor. In fact, you will see the most appropriate health professional. And that's the territory we're in at the moment with the test sites that are going to be developed over the next few months, really pushing the boundaries of what does that multidisciplinary working look like and what will it deliver in terms of better outcomes.
Thank you. OK, Bob Dorris.
Thanks, Convener. I thought I'd ask a little bit about the spending plans for sport. I'm just looking at the draft budget plans before us, and I can see it's a flat cash commitment in terms of revenue for sport, staying at £45.8 million, which is a small real terms decrease in its funding. So understand the budgetary pressures across government, but health has done particularly well in relation to the budget that's been set by the Scottish Government. It'd be quite good to get maybe some information on how that revenue budget for sport might be used. But in doing so, could I also draw your attention to two other budget lines from the health budget, which would include a 7.9% increase in health improvement and health inequalities in the health revenue side of things, and a 69.8%, granted it's only £15.7 million, with a 69.8% increase in the mental health improvement and service delivery budget within the health spend. So the reason I put those two figures on the record is an example of, we've got those figures for sport, but do we have to think in tight financial times when we look at early intervention and preventative spend, do we have to look at a connectivity between that health budget to get people more physically active and sporty, rather than just looking at that £45.8 million? So how would you envisage that being spent, and what connectivity is there between sport and physical activity with the core health budget as well?
Okay. I mean, it has been a tough budget in that, you know, the special boards have, you know, had a relatively kind of tougher settlement, and departmental allocations have obviously reduced because we had to, well, I thought it was right, particularly in this budget, to make a very clear statement of, you know, these are the priorities and we will have to therefore make sure that those other budgets, whereas they might be tough, that we have to also help those organisations and bodies like Sport Scotland, for example, to agree their priorities. And obviously that's done in terms of the letter that will be set out in terms of what we would expect Sport Scotland to deliver in 16-17 for their budget. Priorities within that will be, you know, things like maintaining, for example, the work that Sport Scotland have done with Education Scotland around the PE provision. And if you think about the massive increase now in the delivery of the 2 hours and the two periods, which I think has worked its way through into a kind of stabilisation of the physical activity levels of kids within Scotland, that has meant, you know, that throughout that week that as a minimum at least they're getting more activity within the school day through the PE provision and the active schools network that Sport Scotland also delivers. So within that, we'll be working with Sport Scotland to agree what the priorities are. Obviously, their capital budget has reduced because of the delivery of the National Performance Centre and the Para Sports Centre, although Sport Scotland obviously receives lottery monies and will be able to utilise the lottery monies to help continue to invest in sport. You're right to point to the interface between other budgets like the health improvement budgets, like the education budget as well, and the mental health budget. There is the opportunity, I think, to do more around early intervention and collaboration between using some of those resources in a more effective manner. There's some work that's been done, for example, around the physical activity brief intervention that primary care is in a good place to deliver, where the evidence certainly shows us that the more physically active people are, the better it is for their health and well-being. And how do we build that into part of the work within community health services, that it's about not just treating illness but helping to keep people well, and that the work with third sector organisations is critical to that. I think there's far more scope to do more there. I think we've been scratching at the surface of some of that, and again, I think as we take forward new models of delivery for community health services, I would like to see a stronger link up with third sector organisations, so that, you know, health professionals can be more routinely referring people to exercise classes, you know, third sector organisation providing walking groups, things like that. That does happen, but I think it could happen more systematically.
Okay, thank you.
We've had an interest, obviously, you know, I think we were touching on the sport, in terms of the Commonwealth Games legacy. We had a quiz here earlier, nobody could answer it. What was the total cost of the Commonwealth Games? Oh no, you should know. I didn't intentionally put you on the spot there, but it was
525.
Yeah, just
525.
Yep.
Yeah. So it's not unreasonable to be looking for a, you know, and I think the ambition was looking for a legacy from that, which would increase activity in our previous discussions.
Yeah, absolutely.
And the committee agreed with you that I think in your words, a strong and sustainable coaching and volunteering base would help us deliver that. And we focused on that on our inquiry about identifying that base, sustaining that base, replacing that base, understanding where it is, what it's doing, and where the gaps are. Can we have some assurance that despite the tight budget, that we're using all of these resources that may be in place to ensure that already weak link, I think, because mm-hmm. we've not had much movement and growth in volunteers, and we don't understand where the gaps are and things like that, that will not, that aspect of the you know, the cut in the sport budget will not impact on that area.
Well, legacy is very important, and you know, but it builds on what is already, without a doubt, the kind of mainstay of how sport is delivered in Scotland. And that's, I think, that it's around 10,000 volunteers that support sport across Scotland, without which, you know, the local clubs wouldn't exist. So the legacy from the Commonwealth Games is, you know, sought to build on what is already a fairly well advanced infrastructure there, but to try and reach people and communities that were not taking part in any physical activity or exercise or sport. Now, you know, it's probably more of a slow burn, to be honest. I mean, we knew that there wasn't going to be a kind of eureka moment where everybody suddenly took up exercise and sport. It was going to be over a longer period of time. And I think part of the solution here is creating easier opportunities. I think the school day is very, very important. I've always thought so, which is why, you know, I drove forward when I was a sports minister, the link up with education to deliver a more rounded opportunity in the school day through PE and active schools and sport. And for Sport Scotland's role really to have changed over that period of time, that they don't just see themselves as a sport delivery organisation, they see themselves as a physical activity and PE supporting organisation as well. And that has been a big change for Sport Scotland. So I think getting those early habits through the school day right will be a really important legacy as those children get to their teenage years and then into adulthood. I think there is scope within, if we think a bit more imaginatively around some of the shifting of the balance of care to community services. You can imagine the community hubs, for example, whereas they will of course deliver primary care services and they will deliver all of the services you would want to see, and making sure people are kept out of hospital and all of that. But there is scope for some really good work with third sector organisations around those hubs, where that there's a more systematic mainstream usage by primary care health professionals and others of those third sector assets. So whether it's the local walking group or perhaps patient-led groups, however formal or informal they are, that can help deliver more physical activity within the community. Now, you know, will that happen on its own? Probably not. So I think we, you know, we would need to try and push that through the new models within primary care to get primary care professionals to see that as being an important part, an opportunity for them when they've got patients in front of them.
I mean, I suppose I'm asking, is there anything in the budget to establish what capacity we do have in volunteers? Because when we looked at it at that time, European comparisons showed us it was a poor comparison with other European companies about the number of people who are actually volunteering. And I think we both recognise the greater the volunteer base, the greater opportunity and access that there's going to be derived from that. I mean, we identify 15,000 people as games volunteers. How many has any work been done to establish how many of them remain volunteers delivering sport in the community, which was a...
Yeah, and that's part of the ongoing assessment that is part of the reporting on the legacy of the games, which obviously was happening at set periods. And right, part of that is an analysis of how many volunteers have remained active. And of course, there was a lot of work done to keep in contact with those volunteers. And remember, there was the data sharing aspects at the beginning, so that other, you know, organisations could approach and encourage those volunteers to keep active, maybe not just in sport, but in whatever walk of life. So, you know, that work continues and will be evaluated at key points right the way through to the final evaluation that was to take place of Games Legacy.
Is it 2017?
Yeah, it was 2017.
There was an NUS initiative, and there was also an initiative proposed by yourself about the recognition of volunteers. Has any of that moved on?
I think so, but probably the best thing, because that's a wee bit hazy, convener, from my previous role, I could get you the latest on that, if that would be helpful. We'll get you an update.
There's only one other thing in that sport, and I think it links in with deprivation and the lack of support for some children, that when we looked at that time, 25% of children leaving primary school in Scotland couldn't swim. Now, that's probably higher in some of our communities, because that's communities that have not got that support either through volunteers and parents. So again, I suppose that reduction, that hard budget in sport, shouldn't react in some of these issues. We could be supporting that.
Well, it's all down to the priorities that we agree with Sport Scotland. Yeah. I mean, clearly they will have to deliver some a level of performance sport, which is part of their job, and obviously with the Commonwealth Games fast approaching and the Gold Coast, there will be preparations being put in place for that. But you know, I think Sport Scotland's role has changed to see itself as more of the community work that they carry out, the value of the work they do in schools, the value of participation, and that's a key plank of their work. And what we have to do in working with them through their the priorities being set for the 16-17 budget is to agree what those priorities are. And I very much, I'll feed back to Jamie Hepburn.
Appreciate that. But just as we heard earlier, the analysis of the situation about what works, if we don't know where the volunteers are, we haven't established, the only measure that we use is a household survey. And if we don't know where the gaps are, if we don't know, where the absence of volunteers, how do we nurture that workforce that's going to deliver for us? So, I think the committee agreed that there was an absence of money going to that type of analysis, that rigorous analysis that gives us a two comparison about what we're doing and levels of volunteers, how we're taking them through coaching, like what level they're at and all of that sort of thing, if some, I suppose, academic work is done in and around that. Anyway, thank you. I don't think there's any other questions. Thank you very much.
All right, thank you.
For your attendance and your colleagues for that session. Thank you very much indeed. And we've got a couple of quick things to do before we leave.
In private.
As previously agreed.